Okay, can I have your attention, everybody? At this time, I'm asking that everyone please place all electronic devices to vibrate. All electronic devices to vibrate. Council members, remember that you will have the ability to mute yourself. Thank you very much, Mr. Public Advocate.
Thank you. Good afternoon and welcome to the stated meeting of June 25th, 2020. My name is Jermaine Williams, Public Advocate of the City of New York. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the virtual meeting of New York City Council. If you'd like to follow along, the agenda for today's meeting is posted on our website.
Please join us for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We'll now have today's invocation will be delivered by Bishop R.C.
I'm sorry, Mr. Public Advocate, have to do the roll call.
Yep, that's right.
Adams.
Present.
Ampri Samuel.
Present.
Ayala. Barron. Morelli. Brannon.
Present.
Borelli present. I had a mute problem.
Thank you, council member. Cabrera.
Present.
I'm sorry. Council member Barron also blessed, present, and radical. Thank you.
Thank you, council member Barron. Chin.
Present.
Cohen.
I'm in my kitchen, but I'm here.
Constantinides. Carnegie. Deutsch. Diaz.
Sente.
Drum.
President.
Eugene. Gibson.
Present.
Joni.
Present.
Gudenchik.
Present.
Holden.
Here.
Kalos.
Here.
King. Who?
Present.
Kozlowitz.
Here.
Lanceman.
Present.
Lander.
Here.
Levin. Levine.
Here.
Lewis.
Present.
Mizell.
Here.
Menchaca.
Presente.
Miller. Moya.
Present.
Perkins.
Present.
Powers.
Here.
Reynoso.
Present.
Richards.
Present.
Rivera. Rodriguez. Rose.
Present.
Rosenthal.
Present.
Salamanca.
Present.
Torres.
Present.
Traeger.
Here.
Ulrich.
I'm in BJ's. If anybody needs anything, let me know. I'm here.
Alone. Van Bramer.
Here.
Jaeger.
Here.
Matteo. Combo.
Present.
Speaker Johnson.
I'm here.
Mr. Public Advocate, we have a quorum.
Thank you very much. We'll now have today's invocation, which will be led by and delivered by Bishop R.C. Hugh Nelson, the lead pastor and district administrative bishop of the Church of God of East Flatbush, located at 409 East 95th Street in Brooklyn, New York.
Thank you so very much for this opportunity and pray blessings over you today. Would you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, we humbly approach your throne of mercy and grace, acknowledging you as creator of this world and Lord of our lives. You instructed us in the words of St. Paul. I urge, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings, and for all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. We thank you for each individual seated in this council today and pray your blessings upon them and also for those who are not able to attend. I thank you for the rich diversity of New York City and what it represents around this world. Even though we were forced to battle the viral pandemic of COVID-19 and witness the massive loss of lives, still we celebrate the resilience of the city and the courage of our essential workers. I pray that you'll direct our officials in how to deal with the racial unrest that plagues our country and give us wisdom to correct the wrongs of the past as we celebrate your image in each individual. Help us, O Lord, to live as brothers and sisters, that we may walk in fellowship and compassion and to love one another. I pray that you will use the gifts and abilities within each of us to accomplish the tasks set before us. Help us to maintain a hopeful expectation in the deliberations of the day and to always remember that when our agendas stay focused on the welfare of our constituents, we can always depend on your presence and grace. We pray as we carry out your work of justice and mercy, you will guide our hearts and direct our steps. We pray these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God bless you and have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bishop Nelson. And I'll now call on Councilmember Amphrey Samuel to spread the invocation on the record.
I'm elated to speak on behalf of the Bishop Dr. R.C. Nelson, Senior Pastor of the Church of God of East Flatbush. I've come to know and work very closely with Bishop Nelson and his family, and it is an honor to have him here for today's invocation. A very popular scripture in the Bible is found in the book of Esther, "For such a time as this." And if you are a believer in a higher being and faith, then we accept that some things are designed for such a time as this. Bishop Nelson's work before and with the Church of God of East Flatbush has been community focused and progressive. Considering the tone of the city, we are certainly privileged to have him to be our speaker today. And he practices what he preaches. He's been on the ground with crisis management experience and has stood at the gap between community and police, and has developed affordable housing and many experiences that we in the New York City Council value and run in high regard. Bishop Nelson was born on the beautiful island of Jamaica and migrated to London, England as a young adult and pursued undergraduate studies in theology at the European Bible Seminary in Wittenberg, Germany, and biblical archaeology studies in Jerusalem, Israel. He has a master's in divinity and a doctorate in ministry. Prior to pursuing full-time ministry, Bishop Nelson was employed as a psychotherapist at the Hawassi Mental Health Center program, focused solely on suicidal patients. After serving as pastor in Canada, he moved to New York with his family as a trustee of the Brookdale Hospital and Medical Center and a member of the 67th Precinct Council member and the Brooklyn NYPD task force, Bishop Nelson is a true visionary. So I just want to say thank you, Bishop Nelson, for all that you do on behalf of the community and the great city of New York. And it is my pleasure and honor to make the motion to spread the invocation in full upon the record today.
Thank you, Councilmember Amprey Samuel. I just want to second everything you said, having worked with Bishop Nelson and myself. Those are very true words, but thank you for that. I would now ask Councilmember Coswiss for the adoption of minutes.
I make a motion that the minutes of the stated meeting of May 28, 2020 be adopted as printed.
Thank you. Messages and papers from the mayor?
None.
Communication from city, county, and borough offices?
None.
Petitions and communications?
None.
Land use call-ups?
None.
Thank you. We will now have communication from Speaker Corey Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. Good afternoon, everyone. Happy Thursday. I hope you and your families are safe and well. And I want to thank you for joining us for another virtual stated meeting. This week, our city moved into the second phase of reopening, and I am really proud of the work that New Yorkers all did together to flatten the curve and to get us to this point. The numbers have been showing progress, but we have to keep that up. So I want to remind everyone that we must stay vigilant. We must continue to practice social distancing, and we must wear a mask. Those are two of the most vital tools to prevent the spread of COVID-19. So let's keep up that good work. As of yesterday, our city and state has lost 22,365 of our fellow New Yorkers. 22,365 New Yorkers have died from COVID-19. That number includes probable deaths. I always like to remember that these aren't just numbers, but actual New Yorkers who were loved and will be forever missed. To those who have lost a loved one to this devastating disease, you are in our thoughts and prayers today. As we do during each stated, I also wanna acknowledge those who died from 9/11 related illnesses since our last meeting. The FDNY lost retired firefighter Blaze Del Bianco, who was 66 years old. Let's have a moment of silence for firefighter Del Bianco and the tens of thousands of New Yorkers who we have lost to COVID-19. Thank you. This Friday marks 2 years since the Supreme Court upheld the president's Muslim ban. We said it then and we say it now. Trump's Muslim ban is racist. It goes against everything we stand for, and we will never stop fighting any and every racist policy this White House tries to enact. Hold on 1 second, I apologize. I think I'm having a technical problem. I apologize. We continue to fight for equal rights for everyone, regardless of race, gender, or sexual orientation. And this Sunday marks the 50th anniversary of our city's Pride Parade, celebrating the many achievements of a community which I am proud to be part of, one encouraging love and acceptance. And as we celebrate Pride this month, it is important that we continue to recognize the intersectionality of Black lives and queer lives. Our struggles are not always the same, but we all continue to fight today for fair treatment under the law. This year's march will look very different from prior years, but Pride marches on as it always has. Now let's dive into today's agenda. The council will vote on one Article 11 property tax exemption for 3415 Knox Place in Councilmember Cohen's district in the Bronx to preserve 25 units of affordable housing. Moving on to the rest of our legislative agenda, the council will also be voting on legislation to amend reporting requirements by short-term rental platforms. Introduction 1976, sponsored by Councilmember Carlina Rivera, will amend a law passed by the council in 2018 that required online short-term rental platforms such as Airbnb to provide more information to the Mayor's Office of Special Enforcement. These amendments would tailor those reporting requirements to cover listings for short-term rentals of an entire dwelling unit or housing accommodation and rentals for three or more persons at the same time. And I want to thank from the staff, Audrey Son and Austin Branford, for their help on this bill. Our next bill is one that I worked very closely on with Councilmember Antonio Reynoso and countless small business owners. Our restaurants are part of the fabric and soul of our city. Many people know our city for its restaurant industry, and the culinary experience here is unmatched. The shutdown has devastated so many of these restaurants, and we can't allow them to fail. This is the time to get creative and reimagine our outdoor spaces. Proposed introduction number 1957A, sponsored by Councilmember Antonio Reynoso, will codify the city's outdoor dining program, allowing restaurants and bars to temporarily use outdoor spaces like sidewalks, curbs, and streets. These businesses would be allowed to self-certify that they are using sidewalk and curb space directly in front of their business. Currently, almost 5,000 businesses have utilized the self-certifying process through the City of New York. And from the staff, I want to thank Valkyrie Smirig and Leah Skirpiak. Although this bill addresses the recovery of our restaurant industry, we need to ensure a healthy recovery for our entire city. This next bill requires the city to start planning for the reopening of agency offices. When the virus hit in March, there was no plan for protecting our workers. It was confusing and frankly scary for a lot of city employees. When they go back, city workers need to know what to expect and that we're prepared to keep them safe. Proposed introduction number 1950A, sponsored by Majority Leader Lori Cumbo, would require senior staff from the mayor's office to work with the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene and the Department for Citywide Administrative Services to create policies and protocols to facilitate the safe reopening and operation of individual city agencies. I want to thank the staff who worked on this, CJ Murray, Elizabeth Kronk, and Emily Forgione. The council will also vote on a bill out of the Finance Committee designed to increase transparency around COVID-19 related spending. All too often, a crisis can lead to unchecked spending, but the council is committed to making sure there's always accountability over city spending. Proposed introduction number 1952A, sponsored by Councilmember Vanessa Gibson, would require the City of New York to create an online public database that would track expenditures of federal, state, and local funds for addressing COVID-19. And I want to thank the staff who worked on this, Rebecca Chasen, Stephanie Ruiz, and Nell Beekman. Also from the Finance Committee are two bills and five resolutions that relate to the interest rates for late and early payments of property taxes. First are three annual resolutions that will adopt the rates that were recommended to the council by the city's banking commission. This year's rate include the lowest historical interest rates for quarterly taxpayers, which include over 90% of our homeowners. Those rates will be 3.25% for the first quarter of fiscal 2021 and 5% for the remainder of the year. That is down from 7% in the current fiscal year. The other recommended late payment is 18% for semi-annual payers, which is mostly investor-oriented properties and luxury homes. And the early discount rate of 0.5% remains unchanged from fiscal 2020. However, recognizing that so many of our property owners are struggling financially, the council is voting on two bills and companion resolutions to adopt targeted lower interest rates for COVID-impacted property owners who are unable to pay their July 1st property tax bill on time. Proposed introduction number 1964A, sponsored by Councilmember Margaret Chin, would authorize a 7.5% late payment interest rate available to small rent-regulated apartment and commercial buildings that pay their taxes on a semi-annual basis and have been adversely impacted by COVID-19. The lowered interest rate would be available between July 1st and October 15th. The next, proposed introduction number 1974A, sponsored by our public advocate, Jumani Williams, would authorize a 0% late payment interest rate for COVID-19 impacted homeowners who use their properties as their primary residence and pay who either have incomes below $150,000 who are already in a hardship payment plan. The lowered interest rate would be available between July 1st and September 30th. I want to thank the staff who worked on this, Rebecca Chasen, Emery Adev, Ray Majeski, Andrew Wilbur, and Noah Brick. This past April, the state legislature voted to legalize electric bikes and scooters, but the use of e-bikes and e-scooters was still prohibited by local law in New York City. Today, the council is moving to change that, and this legislation is timely. As the COVID-19 pandemic hit our city, many New Yorkers turned to alternative forms of transportation for essential travel and relied on food deliveries made by cyclists on e-bikes more than ever before. As the city reopens, it's more important than ever that we provide New Yorkers with many options for getting around. It is also important that we focus on justice issues, and we need to deliver justice for these food delivery workers. Proposed introductions numbers 1250A and 1264A, both sponsored by Councilmember Fernando Cabrera, would eliminate local prohibitions on the use of certain e-bikes and e-scooters that are now allowed under state law. Introduction 1250A would allow for the use of privately owned e-scooters with top speeds of under 20 miles per hour. And introduction 1264A would allow for the use of three classes of electric bicycles with top speeds under 25 miles per hour. This legislation would also clarify that devices that remain prohibited by local law may only be impounded if operated in a manner that endangers the safety of the operator or the safety or property of another, and would reduce the previously excessive penalty for operating a prohibited device from $500 to $250. Proposed introduction number 1266A, again, sponsored by Councilmember Fernando Cabrera, would require the Department of Transportation to create a pilot program for the operation of shared electric scooters in New York City. The bill would require that neighborhoods unserved by existing dock-based bike share programs be given priority in determining the geographic boundaries of the pilot program. DOT would be required to issue a solicitation for the pilot by October 15th and would allow for shared electric scooters to be offered to the public no later than March 1st. The bill would also require that the Department of Transportation report to the council on the progress of the program and issue recommendations to the council regarding the creation of a permanent shared electric scooter program. The pilot also requires participating e-scooter companies to make sure their vehicles don't obstruct sidewalks or ramps. This will benefit all New Yorkers walking our narrow sidewalks and especially people with disabilities or restricted mobility. Shared e-scooter operators would also be required to offer e-scooters that are accessible for use by people with disabilities. I want to thank the staff who worked on these bills, Elliot Lynn and Alex Washington. I now turn it back to you, Mr. Public Advocate. Thank you for presiding over today's meeting, and I look forward to proceeding with today's votes after hearing from our colleagues.
Thank you, Speaker Johnson. We'll now move into discussion of general orders. We'll first recognize council members who signed up by email, and then recognize council members who wish to speak by using the raise hand function in Zoom. Please wait, as a reminder, please wait before you begin your remarks for a Sergeant of Arms to announce that he has begun the countdown clock. The Sergeant of Arms will alert you when your time has expired. Can we please begin the list of folks who have signed up?
Mr. Public Advocate, Majority Leader Cumbo, Councilmember Chin, and Councilmember Rivera are the first three speakers.
Thank you very much. Majority Leader Cumbo.
Thank you. I want to thank our public advocate, Jumani Williams. You look almost as good as me up there.
Close. Not yet. Not yet.
Over the last few days, many states, including Arizona, Texas, Arkansas, Tennessee, California, North and South Carolina, have seen a rise in the number of infections of COVID-19. California is now handling roughly 4,732 new cases each day. Texas is at 4,348 cases a day. And the Carolinas are seeing roughly 2,400 new cases every day per NPR. Thankfully, so far, New York City and the state's response plans, safety measures, and clear lines of communication have so far allowed us to continue reopening with only a modest increase in confirmed COVID-19 cases, an exception to the trend of increasing cases in other states across the country. New York City has reported less than 200 new cases a day since last Saturday. My proposed intro 1950A creates a task force of 5 to 10 mayoral appointees to further coordinate restart operations across city agencies. The first iteration of this bill designed a restart officer rather than a task force. In our discussions with the administration, it is clear that they felt the task force would be better equipped to handle the various hurdles with reopening the entire city workforce. Reopening and recommending policies to roughly 320,000 city employees across dozens of agencies, officers, boards is a monumental task. A single restart officer would not have had the rounded experience and expertise that a task force would have. This task force is not a group of volunteers who work regular 9-to-5 jobs time. Provide expertise and opinions related issues. This would be paid staff that have expertise in managerial operations across city agencies. And so this is going to be where the buck stops. These individuals are going to have everything to do with how we train our workforce in order to come back safely, how we make sure that people understand how paid sick days will now operate, and how to experiences in our jobs. Employees deal directly with many people, including vulnerable populations. There have been so many of the elderly, those with pre-existing health conditions, who are concerned about going back.
Did we lose a majority leader? Looks like it. We can move forward to Councilmember Chin.
Oh man, I'm still here. Can you hear me?
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Here I am. So I'll just close with thanking. I'll just close by saying I want to thank my colleagues and all of their work in getting to this. It's important that we get this restart correct. We cannot allow a workforce to come back. There were a lot of missteps early on when COVID-19 first hit New York, and we have paid the price of the loss of many lives. We cannot afford to do that moving forward. And so I want to just thank briefly my senior legislative policy analysis, Emily Forgione, and Elizabeth Kronk, senior counsel Nicholas Connell, legislative counsel Christopher Murray. I want to thank my staff, Jason Herr, Alicia Mercedes, and I also want to thank Tasha Young for all of their work and dedication, and Jason Goldman, and especially Speaker Corey Johnson for recognizing the importance of this and making sure that this council pushed back to make sure that we have a safe reopening plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Majority Leader, and it's an honor to sometimes share this chair with you. So thank you, and thank you for those words. Councilmember Chin.
Time starts now.
Thank you, Public Advocate. Today, we'll be voting on my bill, Intro 1964A, which will reduce the interest rate from 18% to 7.5% on non-payment of July 1st property tax for certain small property owners impacted by COVID-19. This legislation aims to offer some help to a small pool of legacy mom-and-pop property owners of tenement buildings in my district who have too often been neglected and erased by our city and state. They are the owners who have passed on their buildings from family members to family members for generations. Or like in Chinatown, the family association who have shaped and served the community for over a century. They have been victim in an unfair and crippling property tax assessment system, even though they represent century-old tenements with a majority of rent-stabilized tenants Some pay as little as $50 in rent. Now with commercial tenants, their main source of income, having to shut their door overnight, these owners have been desperate in any attempts of intervention. The city has stayed for too long, turned a blind eye to their unique challenges and call for relief. This legislation is by no means the silver bullet to the inequity and this constituency face, but it is a first step and a sign that we need to start listening. I want to remind the mayor that this is a tax deferral program, not an exemption. 7.5 interest rate is a start, but we know that we can and should do better to lower it, to offer real breathing room for everyone to get back on their feet. This is about neighborhood survival. This is about preserving the deeply affordable housing that we have. This wasn't an easy fight at all. So I want to thank the finance team, including Latanya.
Time expired.
Rebecca Chasen, all the staff, Marion Guerra, my staff, and definitely the speaker, Jason and Chair Drum, for your incredible leadership. And I urge my colleague to vote on the bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Chin. Councilmember Rivera.
Starting time.
Thank you so much, Mr. Public Advocate, for the opportunity to speak on Intro 1976, which will make amendments to my short-term rentals reporting law, Local Law 146 of 2018, a bill I introduced and passed with a veto-proof majority. I'm happy to see that after 2 years of legal battles, this amendment bill will allow New York City's short-term rental reporting law, the strongest of its kind in the nation, to help the countless families we represent access affordable homes. These tools will give enforcement power to effectively crack down on illegal hotel operators that have kept thousands of apartments out of our housing stock. I want to thank the City Law Department, the Office of Special Enforcement, Kelly Taylor and our council legal team, Jason Goldman, and my staff, including the tireless Jeremy Unger, for their work during the nearly 2 years we spent working to defend this important and historic housing law. I look forward to seeing my bill, one of my first ever passed in the council, finally go into effect. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we have the next three council members' names?
Yes, Mr. Public Advocate. The next three are council members Cabrera, Gibson, and Menchaca.
Thank you. Councilmember Cabrera.
Starting time.
Thank you so much to my esteemed colleagues. Today, I'm proud to share my legislations, Intro 1258, 1266A, and 1264A, which will enable New Yorkers to benefit from environmentally progressive alternative transportation in the form of e-scooters and e-bikes in a safe, affordable, and responsible manner. This is about transportation equity. For 2 years, environmental and environmental justice advocates have been fighting for the ability to bring clean electric scooters to New York City. Why? Communities like mine, which are poorly served by public transportation, have no shared bike program and have among the highest level of asthma in the country, are always left out in the cold, and to be honest, I'm tired of it. I see people buying $2,000 bottles from Amazon and using it to avoid the subways and buses during COVID-19 pandemic. My constituents cannot afford such a luxury. Share scooters provide poor and working class everyday New Yorkers, particularly in communities of color, to share these devices and only use them when they need them, when they are done with their commute to work and another transportation system, or to ride the doctor or the supermarket, the neighbors can use it, and so on, and it works. I see my time is expiring here. I know there are concerns regarding how long these scooters last, and let me just set the facts straight. They last for 18 months. This is why environmental organizations in this city have endorsed it. And this is why the New York League of Conservation Voters, Transportation Alternative, Environmental Advocate, the Tri-State Campaign for Transportation, Regional Plan Association.
Time's expired.
The Queens Chamber of Commerce and the Waterfront Alliance have all endorsed it. And let me thank Elliot Lynn, Alex Washington, and Michael Rick Arvello, and Jason Golden, and of course, our speaker, for your support. I'll speak more about it during my time. Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate.
Thank you very much, Councilmember Gibson.
Thank you so much, Mr. Public Advocate. And good afternoon, Speaker, and all of my colleagues and everyone who's watching today. Blessed Thursday to each and every one of you. I am proud to talk briefly about my bill, Introduction 1952A, which would require the City of New York to create a public database on its website that would track expenditures of federal, state, and local funds for addressing COVID-19, including all agency spending, city procurement contracts, grants, and loans. The structure of this legislation was inspired by the Superstorm Sandy tracker that was created as a part of Local Law 140 of 2013, and the mayor will create and maintain a public online searchable interactive database for the City of New York that will include a summary of all management of COVID-19 funds available in a format that's easy to read for the general public, looking at all of the agencies that provide funds for the City of New York for the purposes of COVID-19 spending. This bill really will serve as a powerful accountability and transparency tool to ensure that resources are reaching the hardest hit communities across our city. We understand that many New Yorkers have lost their battle to COVID-19, many New Yorkers of color and older New Yorkers. And we have to make sure that as we spend COVID-19 dollars, they are equitable and really investments in the communities that are most hardest hit by COVID-19. It is our responsibility to ensure that resources are concentrated in areas of vulnerability where New Yorkers need the most. And I want to thank my co-sponsor, our colleague, Mark Traeger, who really did a lot to help move this bill forward. Our speaker, Corey Johnson, for his leadership, Chair of Finance, Chair Danny Drum, all the members of the Finance Committee, and really all of the sponsors and all of my colleagues, and certainly the Legislative Division and the Finance Division. Thank you for your hard work. This is a good bill that will really move this city forward in recognizing that we have to track all of our COVID-19 spending as we move forward. Thank you so much, and I urge all my colleagues to vote in the affirmative. Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate.
Thank you, Councilmember, and we have Councilmember Menchaca.
Starting time.
Our forgotten immigrant delivery workers are forgotten no more. For years, immigrant workers who use e-bikes have been harassed, fined, and arrested by the NYPD for keeping New Yorkers fed. It took a global pandemic to teach New Yorkers, especially this mayor, that these workers are essential and their work should not be criminalized. Now, with legislation we are passing today, we are taking a step closer to building a sanctuary city and honor our commitment to protect essential workers as we recover. The workers are working on some far-sighted agendas and we need to deliver justice. However, the e-scooters and the bills connected to these e-scooters is not transformative. They have fed and continue to feed the twin disasters known as climate change and corporate greed. The only reason e-scooters are part of this package is because of the corporate interests, which show us how nakedly they want to exploit an effort to protect essential workers for profit. After this vote, there's a lot more that we can do. The state law authorizes all e-bikes to have a sticker identifying it as a legal device starting in 2022. For now, all the e-bikes are exempted, but we have to force manufacturers to send those stickers. There's still a lot of work to do for the e-bikes, and I want you to reconsider for all the reasons that I have said, but all the reasons that you are knowing as you connect to the communities that you represent, to vote no on the e-scooter bills, just vote yes on the e-bike bills, and let's keep talking about all the transportation alternatives that are in our work as we move for a just transition. That's what I'm asking. And I know there's a lot of support, but this happened so fast and I'm not ready. And someone who has been deeply embedded in this work, I'm asking my colleagues to vote no on the e-scooter bills. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And can we have the next three council members?
Yes, Mr. Public Advocate. The next three are council members Jonai, Koo, and Yeager.
Thank you, Councilmember Jonai.
Starting time.
Thank you, Public Advocate. Let me just begin by encouraging all of my colleagues to pay attention to what we're voting on today. 1347, 18% interest for non-payment of taxes for properties valued over $250,000, which includes co-ops, is unjustifiable during good times. During this crisis, it's immoral. The Banking Commission is required to propose a rate of at least 6% per annum greater than the prevailing interest rate charged for commercial loans extended to prime borrowers by commercial banks in the city. The Banking Commission notes that as of 5/13/20, the prime rate is around 3.25%, meaning we have the current authority to limit the interest to a rate of 9.25% and not twice that, which is what we're voting on today. 1348, 3.25% for the first quarter, fiscal 2021, and 5% for the remainder of the fiscal year for properties valued not more than $250,000, which includes co-ops, should have been left at zero or at least remain at 3.25% during the entire fiscal year and until we recover from the crisis. Intro 1349, 7.5% for properties valued between $250,000 and $750,000 that were adversely affected by COVID-19 is immoral and unjustifiable. The rate should have been left at zero or at minimum 3.25% until we recover from this crisis. I represent a community with the highest effective tax rate in the entire city. I remind my colleagues that the list of the highest effective tax rates in the city, the first 32 are in the outer boroughs. 32 of the outer borough council members have the highest effective tax rate. The most vulnerable, the poorest, those that are in the most need, pay the highest effective tax rate in the city. I'm wrapping up. If the rezo passes in their current form, we should be held accountable by our constituents. I urge all of my colleagues to vote no on 1347, 1348, and 1349 to do right by our homeowners and small businesses. We need to give them a fighting chance to survive this crisis. We can't allow them to be a fatality. It's in our hands and in our power. Thank you, public.
Thank you very much. Councilmember Koo.
Starting time.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. I'm very happy to vote in favor of today's e-bike bills. This will provide such a great relief to many immigrant delivery workers who have been penalized just for doing their jobs for far too long. Congratulations to Councilmember Cabrera and all delivery workers in New York City. This is a great moment that we have fought for a long time. On the other hand, I have serious reservations about e-scooter sharing program. While I do believe people should be allowed to use them, I think we need to take a step back and observe how our city can function by allowing them on our streets before we jump into a sharing program. Friendly, I worry about what downtown area of my district will look like with a shared e-scooter program competing for space among buses, sidewalk vendors, diners, and pedestrians. Finally, I'll be voting in support of the outdoor dining legislation with the expectation that we will not be placing these spaces in areas that must compete with heavy pedestrian traffic and bus stops. So with this in mind, I will be voting no on intro 1266A and yes on the rest. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. And Councilmember Yeager.
Starting time.
Thank you, Mr. President. First, my continued gratitude to Mr. Speaker and the Chief of Staff and the members of the Finance staff for their continued work to negotiate a fair budget for all New Yorkers. This is perhaps the most important work this body does, and I'm grateful to all who are working diligently on this important task. This is the third time since I joined the Council that we are being called on to impose an interest charge on New Yorkers who are unable to pay their property taxes on time. In each of the last 2 years, I voted no. And last year, 11 and 13 members of the council joined in opposing these resolutions. This year, more than ever, we need to seriously look at what we're doing to New Yorkers. people don't skip their tax payments because they don't feel like paying. And now, more than ever, we know New Yorkers are having trouble paying their bills. Rates are usurious. And while I congratulate Mr. Public Advocate and Councilmember Chin for advancing legislation to assist New Yorkers who can't pay their taxes on time, I think we should stand up for our New Yorkers and do a little better. As Councilmember Chin said, we can do better and we should do better. Obviously, we don't want people taking interest-free loans from the city if they can afford to make their payments. And Mr. Speaker is right that in one of these resolutions, it is a lower rate than in the past, but I do think we can do better. Thus, today, I propose amendments to the items on the floor today. Pursuant to Council Rule 9.40, the proposed amendments will be transmitted to the legislative document unit as I began speaking. With permission, Mr. President, I would ask that the clock be extended for 2 minutes pursuant to Rule 9.40 if my time expires, so I may explain the four proposed amendments. My proposed amendment to Reso 1347 would strike all references to an 18% interest rate and replace it with a 2% rate. These are the rates charged to properties with assessed valuations of over $250,000, and as Mr. Speaker indicated, higher valued properties. Still, and nonetheless, 18% is just wrong. We can do better. 2% is fairer and still encourages those who can to pay on time.
Time's expired.
My proposed amendment to Resos 1348 and 1349, which strikes all references to 3.25, 5%, and 7.5%, and insert zero instead, as would my proposed amendment to Intro 19. Again, this is a one-time change for this year alone to allow New Yorkers who are facing trouble times the ability to come out from under their debt. Zero interest for middle-class New Yorkers who own their own homes or small properties just makes sense. It's the right thing to do and enables those who are landlords to extend rent protection and help the tenants who are not able to make payments right now. I urge my colleagues to join me, please, in supporting these proposed amendments today right here on the floor to instill some fairness in our tax collection system to give our neighbors some breathing room during these difficult economic times. Thank you, Mr. President.
Mr. Public Advocate.
Yes.
The meeting will stand at ease.
Meeting stands at ease.
Councilmember Yeager.
Yes, sir.
Have you reduced your amendment to writing?
Yes, sir. It was emailed to the Legislative Documents Unit at the LDU email address as I began speaking.
Great. Thank you very much, Councilmember Yeager. The meeting will stand at ease.
Mr. Public Advocate.
Yes.
We can resume the meeting. Is Jonathan Ettricks from the Legislative Documents Unit on the call?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Jonathan, can you please read the proposed amendments that you have received in writing into the record?
Thank you, Mr. Parliamentarian. This is from Council Member Yeager. He proposes an amendment to intro number 1964, striking all references to 7.5% and inserting zero instead. He proposes an amendment to resolution 1347, striking all references to 18% and inserting 2% instead. He proposes an amendment to resolution 1348, striking all references to 3.25% and 5% and inserting zero instead. And finally, he proposes an amendment to resolution 1349, where he strikes all references to 7.5% and inserts zero instead.
That concludes the Jonathan. Mr. Public Advocate, debate can now begin on these four amendments. The first council member to be recognized is the person who has offered the amendments. Council Member Yeager, do you wish to speak on your four amendments?
Thank you, Mr. Parliamentarian, thank you, President. I'll be brief. I don't have much to add. I think in this council, there are members here like me from all across the city who represent the kind of people who I represent. Middle-class New Yorkers who are struggling to make ends meet, struggling and every single day calling our offices and telling us that they just got the July tax bill and they can't pay it, they don't have the money. And the public advocate and council member Chin have advanced legislation to address them. And they've done a great service, in my view, to the people of New York. But I think we can do better. I think we can stop this interest after this year. And keeping in mind, as members have said here, the city will ultimately get its money. The city does not have to rely on New Yorkers to fund a loan sharking operation in essence of these high usurious rates. 3.5%? What bank in New York City is paying 3.5% for money in the bank? Why does the city feel the need to do this? The Banking Commission is not us. We have the right under state law to reject what the Banking Commission has done. I think this is in line with what a lot of members want to do, which is why last year, 11 and 13 members joined together to vote no on the bill. This year, more than ever, my friends, we have to stand up for our fellow New Yorkers. We have a chance to do it now. Insert zero. We won't delay anything. We won't hurt the city. This is a chance to tell New Yorkers, we feel your pain, understand what's going on. We get it, and we're going to help you out. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilmember Yeager. Mr. Public Advocate, we can now open debate to other council members. So far, council members Drum, Miller, Rosenthal, and Holden have said that they would like to speak. You can first recognize the chair of our Finance Committee, Councilmember Drum.
Just so I have it clear, it's Drum, Miller, Rosenthal, and who else?
Holden.
Thank you, Mr. Parliamentarian. I recognize Chair Drum.
Starting time.
Thank you very much. I would like to make a point of information in regard to Intro 1349 with the 7.5% interest rate, which is pursuant to Intro 1964. We don't have the legal authority to change that. It's either an up or down vote. There's no legal authority by which we can change that. So I would like to go back and record on this. We can't just change it. We don't have the legal authority to do that. I'd like to ask for council's opinion. And we can't extend the zero rate either.
Thank you, Councilmember Drum. We will see if we can get a legal opinion on whether we can amend the 7.5% to zero.
Thank you.
As a point of parliamentary order, there is currently no amendment proposed. Oh, there is. There is an amendment proposed to Intro 1964, and everyone should know that if we were to amend Intro 1964, we would have to wait until the following stated to vote on the amended version of Intro 1964. While we wait for counsel on Councilmember Drum's point, Mr. Public Advocate, you can call on our next speakers.
Councilmember Miller, followed by Councilmember Rosenthal, followed by Councilmember Holden.
Starting time.
I have an objection.
Sorry?
I have an objection. How can we have a discussion on something that is not legally possible? I would ask that we get the legal recognition first, and that if it's okay, then we have a discussion.
Mr. Parliamentarian, can I just ask that the state stand at ease one more time?
The meeting will stand at ease.
Thank you.
Mr. Public Advocate.
Yes.
We're ready to resume the meeting.
Okay.
The Finance Chair, Chair Drum, asked for a parliamentary point of order, whether we could in fact consider an amendment to a resolution that may make the underlying resolution legally invalid. The council is able to consider any resolution, even if perhaps some might say that it would be legally invalid. That's a point for council members to consider. It is not something that would prohibit Councilmember Yeager from making an amendment to a resolution. With that answered, we can continue debate, starting with Councilmember Miller.
Thank you. Councilmember Miller.
Starting time.
Thank you so much, Mr. Public Advocate. As you know, I represent the community of the Greater Jamaica Community of Queens and Southeast Queens in particular, which is the largest African-American homeowners throughout the nation. And we have been gravely, also it's the same community that were gravely impacted by the COVID-19 pandemic. Those things being considered, we have often been victimized from predatory banking practices. In fact, the matter is over the last 10 years, 50% of the mortgages sold have been predatory mortgages in the Greater Jamaica area. For that reason, we are very sensitive. I'd like to speak on behalf of my colleagues in Southeast Queens as well. We are very sensitive to these predatory numbers that the city has been preying on homeowners for so long. Particularly during this moment of COVID, we would hope that this could be addressed. I wrote a dear colleague sent a dear colleague sign on that we sent to the administration asking to postpone and to address this, and they obviously denied and referred us to this program that is highly, in my mind, highly predatory. And so I commend my colleagues who have introduced legislation addressing this. It is my hopes that in many instances it could be zero as well. I don't think that the city should be in the business of banking either. But I do understand that there are some dynamics involved in it, particularly in this moment of fiscal crisis that we find ourselves in. Also that there have been some negotiations that have
expired.
So I would like to ensure that the whatever we vote on, that it happens expeditiously. So that is my two cents, and I look forward to moving forward with this legislation.
Thank you. Councilmember Rosenthal?
Starting time.
Thank you very much. Give me 1 second. Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. I have not experienced this type of situation where a member brings up changes during a stated meeting. We just had a vote on this issue in the Finance Committee, and these issues were not raised at that time. To begin with, I think I would need to see what the Councilmember Yeager is proposing, and I'm hoping you could share that with the other council members, all of us, so we might even know what we're voting on. I understand you read it into the record, but I could not absorb it. So I would appreciate council sending that around. And I feel not sufficiently, this issue, I have not, was, as I say, not raised in the Finance Committee. So it was not something that has been proposed to me before. Perhaps other council members had seen this, not me. And I need a lot more information before I could be asked to vote on this. I think Councilmember Drum raises legal concerns. I just don't understand why. So my two cents is, I think if council members were gonna vote on this, we need to not be blindsided in this way, number one, and need some consideration to understand what we would be voting on. If I'm asked to vote on this second, I would vote no for what Councilmember Yeager is proposing, merely for the reason that I have no idea.
What is the status of the meeting?
Thank you.
Sorry, Councilmember Rodriguez. We are in the meeting now, and the next person up is Councilmember Holder. Councilmember Rosenthal, gave a couple extra seconds to finish her thought. Assuming that she's finished now, we can go to Councilmember Holder.
Mr. Public Advocate.
Sorry.
Before Councilmember Holden speaks, as a point of parliamentary order, the proposed amendments have been distributed to all council members.
Thank you.
Mr. Public Advocate, before Councilmember Holden speaks, I just want to be clear that I do not support the amendments that are being offered. And I just want to reiterate on two of the amendments that are offered, it would be legally invalid. We don't have the legal authority to do what two of these amendments are seeking for us to do, which would be embarrassing for the city council to vote to do something that we legally do not do. It is not legal, as Chair Drum said.
I'm sorry, Councilmember Rosenthal, you had like 5 more seconds if you wanted to finish what you were saying. You're on mute.
You're still on mute. Helen, you're on mute. Okay, so let's go to
Councilmember Holden.
Okay.
What in time?
You know, without the question of the legality, I just want to commend my colleague from Brooklyn for standing up for the middle class with this amendment. I think it's about time. Even before this pandemic crippled our economy, I have every year voted no on these types of resolutions that are being proposed today in the council, which I believe, if adopted, the interest rate of a non-payment of property taxes is too high a rate. The middle class in this city continues to be treated as a cash cow by City Hall. And instead of giving relief at this difficult time for many in our city residents, our solution is to barely lower the rates, which is being proposed. So when it should be 0% for the first quarter of 2021 and much lower for the following quarter. So it's no wonder people are fleeing the city. So I support the amendment, you know, again, if we have established that it's legal. Thank you.
Mr. Parliamentary.
Public Advocate, we have the following members signed up to speak.
Hold on a second, Mr. I just want to reiterate to the council member, two of the amendments are not legal. It's not like a question of maybe it's legal, maybe it's not legal. It is clear that two of the amendments that are being offered are not legally valid. So we as a council would be voting to do something that is not legally valid.
Just for a point of information as well, is it one amendment including all of those, Mr. Parliamentarian, or is it several amendments that are voting on?
Mr. Public Advocate, it would be 4 separate amendments.
Thank you. Is anyone else signed up to speak?
Yes. Council members Koo, Jonai, Yeager, Chin, and Lanceman.
Sorry, Koo, Jonai, Yeager, and Lanceman.
Chin,
and Lanceman.
And then Lanceman.
Thank you. Councilmember Koo?
Starting time.
Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. I support Councilmember's amendment because I think for a long time, this administration has taken property owners for granted. Property owners or small businesses really the city to enforce quality of life issues. Homelessness, we should send homeless people to their shelters, don't stay on the streets. We should send those illegal vendors to different places to find a job or train them for different jobs because they are competing with legal businesses who are paying employees tax and property tax, all these things. And we are tired of seeing people peeing on the streets. And nobody pay attention to these. There's no, the property owners pay a lot of money for the service, right? But there's no service provided, especially lately. The city has been ignoring property owners. They try to demonize them. And when there's a looting, they didn't go out to protect them. They didn't even say sorry for them. So for a long time, I think property owners have to stand together and to tell this administration, enough is enough. They have to do something for us, for the small property owners, for the small property business owners and property owners. Because otherwise, why would we be the cash cow for the city and they are not feeding us?
Time's expired.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Jonai.
Thank you, Public Advocate. Before my time begins, I have a question for the parliamentarian because I'm not sure which two proposals are illegal or not legal. I'm not clear on this.
Thank you, Councilmember Jonai. I will seek counsel and get back to the body as quickly as possible.
No, I can tell you the two that are legally invalid, I believe, are 1349 and 1350. Those are two that we do not have the authority to change in the way that's being asked.
So 1348 and 1347, we can change. We have the legal right.
Yes.
Okay, great. So let me begin by first thanking everyone. And I want us for the record, could I speak now?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Just for the record, I hate the fact that Councilmember Yeager introduced this, and it wasn't me. So thank you, Calman, for being so aggressive and proactive. I want to remind everyone that we have a responsibility to be advocates for our constituents, and we have respect for one another. We may not always agree, but we should hear each other out on the issues that are important to us. And I'm just going to give a rundown of the highest effective real estate tax rates for Class 1 properties by council district. I mentioned in my opening remarks that the first 32 highest effective tax rates are in the outer boroughs. And you should be aware of what, according to the 2017 chart that I have, those districts are from highest to lowest, 13th Council District, 51st Council District, 18th, 12, 50, 49, 11, 23, 27, 32, 45, 31, 15, 46, 28, 17, 24, 48, 42, 19, 30, 41, 25, 20, 21, 29, 26, and we finally get to Manhattan, District 14. So all of the outer boroughs, the poorest and the most neediest, pay the highest effective tax rates in the city of New York. I commend Calman and all my colleagues for sending that message back to City Hall. Enough is enough. We owe it to our we owe it to our homeowners and to our small businesses. We have to support them in their most time of need. And this is the crisis that has probably opened up everyone's eyes. Our property owners, whether they be small or large, should be standing together and fighting back to make sure that our tax dollars are used wisely, and usury rates of 18% should be illegal. We wouldn't tolerate it from anyone else. So I support the measures, provided they are legal. And if the two proposals that are legal, I fully encourage this body to rethink what interest rate they want to charge their own constituency. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Councilmember Yeager.
Mr. President, might I yield to the next speaker and speak at the end of the list? This way I'd be able to respond to any of the concerns that had been raised.
Sure, Councilmember Chin.
Starting time.
Thank you, Public Advocate. Look, I understand my colleague's sentiment. I've been fighting on this issue for many years, and there is no equality in property tax assessment and how property tax are being collected. A lot of time, the small building owner are lumped together with the big building owner, and that's why there was a property tax reform commission. This is a larger issue. It's not so simple. But what I've been fighting for with the legislation was some breathing room for these property, small property owner. And they came to the hearing and they told their story. Okay, we need greater reform and we have to work together on that. But last minute coming up with this is not fair. This is a bigger issue and it's also involved the state. So I think that we really have to look at this comprehensively. And the city needs to collect the property tax. That's how services are being paid. We have a big budget gap right now, and we have to encourage everyone who can pay their property tax. And if you cannot pay, at least get some relief. That's all we're talking about with this bill. It's not, you know, the panacea. We still got a lot of work to do. So don't raise things last minute. This is something that we have to work together continuously. So I asked my colleague, if you're really serious about equality in property tax assessment, let's sit down and talk about it, okay? There are so many issues that people don't want to address. And let's get those out in the open. But meanwhile, I'm urging you to support the legislation that was put forward, that we need some breathing room and some relief for the small property tax owner. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. Councilmember Yeager. I'm sorry, Councilmember Lansman.
Starting time.
Thank you. I just want to understand, has there been any kind of fiscal analysis of what the impact of these resolutions would be and these amendments would be? I don't know if it's appropriate protocol for me to address that to Councilmember Yeager, or whether or not the finance division has an answer. But does anyone know what would be the fiscal impact of us adopting these amendments to the resolution?
Let me respond, Councilmember Lansman. We don't have an exact fiscal impact on this because, again, it was offered at the last minute and it wasn't discussed at the Finance Committee, which took a vote on this today. But just to be clear, as we are negotiating the budget, there are issues about cash flow that the city controller has projected, and our available cash is a lot less than it has been in years past. We need around $1 billion a week to make payroll and other payments for the city of New York. And reducing the interest rate for late payments from 18% to 2% would likely induce big payers to delay their payments. It could make our cash issues much more difficult. And so what you saw today was a balancing act of us trying to target relief to owner-occupied and small homeowners while also understanding the larger cash issues that the city is facing right now with a record deficit. So we don't have an exact dollar amount, but I'll tell you that if this went through, as projected, it could create some very significant cash issues for the city of New York.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Speaker. So I think that it's extremely difficult, almost impossible, to really think about these amendments in the time that they've been made. I don't want to be critical of my colleague, but I was not made aware of these amendments before this meeting. We had a finance committee meeting. I don't believe the issue was raised there, certainly not in any detail. And as the speaker used the phrase balancing act, we are in the middle, not the middle, we are in towards the end of trying to negotiate our way out of an $8, $9 billion budget hole. The budget negotiating team is meeting constantly. It is simply impossible, and I'm gonna go so far as to say irresponsible, to contemplate voting for these amendments while we're in the middle of all of this without being able to take in put these amendments in that context. So without in any way diminishing the importance of this issue, what it means for the homeowners in my district, of which there are many, myself included, I don't think this is the appropriate moment, the appropriate forum to vote for these amendments. Love to continue this conversation once we, as part of the budget process, further, but I'm going to vote against the amendments, and I urge my colleagues to do likewise.
Point of information.
Mr. Public Advocate.
The following council members wish to speak. Council members Cabrera, Vallone, Drum, and Yeager. As a point of parliamentary information, council member Drum, you can ask your question and be recognized when you were called on after council members Cabrera and Vallone.
I'm sorry, just give me the list again, council members Cabrera, Vallone, and who else?
Drum and Yeager.
Okay, thank you. Council member Cabrera.
Start in time.
Thank you, public advocate. Mr. Public Advocate, I would like to ask a question to the sponsor of the bill regarding the hardship provision. I would use the rest of my time so you could answer the question regarding what is the provision for the hardship? What is the hardship provision within the bill?
Point of information again. Can I speak as chair of the finance committee, through whom's committee the bill went through?
Parliamentarian, there have been questions asked about
information regarding the bill that have not been answered.
Yes, Parliamentarian, I'm pretty sure someone can't see the time necessary to have someone answer a question, but there are some very important questions that have been asked. So to get that answer, Do parliamentarian, can you get that information and get it back? We can wait till Council Chair Drum's time to speak so he can answer all those questions. Please guide me in the best way to make sure those questions are answered.
Mr. Public Advocate, you can recognize council members as you see fit. So you can recognize Chair Drum.
Chair, I'd like to certainly recognize Chair Drum to answer some of those questions.
I would like folks to know and to understand that this legislation actually reduces the penalties on those families who have been affected by COVID. This is a reduction in the penalties. This is not an increase. And I just wanted people to understand that. It is not an increase. If we were to go to zero, the potential for bankruptcy exists and layoffs would be possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Parliamentarian, are you in a position, are you able to just repeat what those amendments were for 49, 50, 47, 48, so people can understand?
Yes, Mr. Public Advocate.
Yes.
To repeat, the proposed amendments are to intro 1964 to strike all references to 7.5% and insert zero instead. To resolution 1347.
So I'm sorry, just so I'm clear, so 1964, that is after the time when they had 0% interest, and now we're in October and they haven't been able to pay. Is that correct? Oh, 1964 is, that's Council Member Chin's bill.
1964 would authorize a 7.5% late payment available to small rent-regulated apartment and commercial buildings.
Thank you. I retract my question. I was talking about the wrong bill. So 1964. Okay, please continue.
Resolution 1347 would strike all references to 18% and insert 2% instead. Resolution 1348 would strike all references to 3.25% and 5% and insert 0 instead. And Resolution 1349, the amendment would strike all references to 7.5% and insert 0 instead. As a parliamentary order clarifying the discussion earlier about the opinion of council as to which would have legal authority, of the four proposed amendments, it is the proposed amendment to Resolution 1349, striking all references to 7.5%, inserting 0 instead, that would not have valid legal authority.
And 1348 as well?
No.
Okay, thank you. We have Council Member Ballone. If Council Member Drum would like to speak again, and then Council Member Yeager.
Thank you. We good to go?
Councilman Ballone?
Yes, just I was waiting to be
right. The Sergeant.
So
I'm sorry, Sergeant, is the time running?
Yes, yeah, starting time.
Sorry, go ahead.
That's what I was waiting for. We've been having this argument without really anyone listening for 7 years. So we're always in favor of giving some relief to the families that pay for everything in the city and basically get nothing back. So the real estate taxes have been used to pay for pretty much everything we've come up with. However, the format, you know, I'm a big part of our council, our institution. I've always believed that. Ballone's always have. Stand strongly with our speaker. It's not proper to do this to our fellow body at a time when our city is struggling. So I oppose the method that was done today, and it should have been clearly brought forth and debated by everyone. But I can clearly support the reduction in real estate tax for homeowners on residential homes. If you look at where those taxes go, it's not coming back to the homes that are paying. So I'll always support an increase if it's a decrease of taxes, if it's done the correct way. But I'm not in favor of at this late moment, with the amount of days that are left and the chaos that the city is facing, we need to show leadership and done the right way. And it's time for us to be leaders and not kowtow to advocates and folks that are out there telling us what to do. We know what to do. So it's time for us to step up, do the right things, balance this budget the right way, and not do things that are necessary. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Councilmember Drum, you're on cue, so do you want to speak again?
Well, yes, I just want to say that if we don't collect our taxes, or if we don't have a penalty for those who don't pay, then they're not going to pay. So how do they recommend that we collect taxes from people? I think that, you know, you have to in some way incentivize people, and those who are paying early get a benefit, and those who are paying late get less of a penalty, a lot less of a penalty than they would have in the past. So I am opposed to this resolution. Thank you.
Thank you. And Councilmember Yeager.
Start in time.
Thank you, Mr. President. I appreciate the vibrant debate here. I want to note a number of things. First of all, yesterday afternoon at 3:15, members of the Finance Committee received an email from staff of the council informing them what items would be voted on this morning at Finance, and these resolutions, the interest resolutions, were not on that email. It was not included on the email to members of the Finance Committee until 8:03 p.m. last night. I do apologize for the late notice. This is not the first time to correct one of my colleagues who indicated that never in her life had she seen a resolution proposed, an amendment proposed on the floor. It was done just a few months ago by my friend from Queens regarding a very important issue here in the council. And it's been done. And it's not untoward to do that. That's why we have a rule that says that it's okay to do it this way. It specifically anticipated that in the case of emergency, which is what this is, because this was so last minute. Reality is, and I appreciate the legal advice that's been sought. This council has in the past asked things that some people have thought were legal, turned out to be not legal. Some people thought were illegal, turned out to be legal. I have been wrong in the past. I am the first to admit that. Other members have been wrong in the past. The item before us on the floor is whether or not we're going to stand with the people of New York and reduce the burden that they have. And it's an important question. If it turns out that our vote and the amendment, and that it turns out that the amendment is not lawful, all that will happen is that there's no interest rate. Nothing bad will happen. And if we recall the presentation made last year when this was presented to us, presented as we don't really make a lot of the city in the big scheme of things from the interest. I will also note in my remaining time as public advocate, I beg for indulgence, the mayor's office is circulating a text to members, not to me, that's okay. This Kalman floor amendment, is inadvisable. It will bankrupt the city and we will have no money for services. Please, if you believe the other side of the building, the finances of this city, vote no. Go ahead. If you believe that the other side of the building tells you the truth about the finances of this city, go ahead and vote no.
Councilmember Yeager.
Thank you, Mr. President. I appreciate the time and I appreciate all my colleagues for this lively and vibrant debate. Thank you.
Mr. Public Advocate.
Yes.
There are three other members who wish to speak on debate on Councilmember Yeager's four proposed amendments.
Okay.
The council continues to seek legal advice regarding the legality of the four amendments. The three members who wish to debate the proposed amendments are council members Kozlowitz, Joni, and Deutsch.
Thank you. Council member Kozlowitz.
Starting time.
I'm going to wait until I vote to give remarks.
Thank you. Councilmember Joni?
Starting time.
Thank you again, public advocate. And just for the record, we are not looking to reduce the real estate taxes. The amendments that have been put forth by Councilmember Yeager are to lower the interest rates. And I want to make that point clear. This morning, I voted. I was not aware that, and because of technical difficulties I was having, I saw the email from yesterday at 3:15, knowing what we're voting on. I was not aware of the 8 p.m. email that was sent out amending the agenda. And I sit on finance. And this morning, I voted for the motion to approve all of the bills. I only found out thereafter that these bills were added on, and I called to ask to see if I could amend my vote, and I was told sorry that once the vote has been placed. So we've seen a few things happen here today that probably could have been avoided, and in transparency, we should look to solve and prevent from happening in the future. But these motions that are being made are justifiable. I mentioned to you the highest effective tax rates in the city of New York, now paying 18% interest and having the highest effective tax rate is hurting our very own constituency and communities. The first 19 with the lowest effective tax rates are in Manhattan. Outside 32 of our council districts on the outer boroughs are paying the highest effective tax rate. If not, we may not be able to change that until we bring actual reform to the real estate tax structure. But today, we can send that message clear. That interest rates of 18% and 7.5% and 3.5% are way too high for struggling New Yorkers. We're going to be held accountable for the vote that we did today. I commend all of you for bringing this up and fighting alongside of our property owners, small and large. And I don't think the highest interest rate, the effective tax rates in Manhattan are valid either. I support them as well. But I want to point out to all my colleagues that it's your communities that are paying more than their fair share.
Councilmember Joni?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Councilmember Deutsch.
Starting
thank
time.
Thank you very much. And I just want to say that I'm very happy that Councilman Yeager brought up this amendment that I just heard for the first time on the floor today. And we always speaking about equity here in the city of New York, and we haven't seen much equity when it comes to my constituents. And once the amendment is brought up, how could I say no? I support this amendment because my constituents are nickeled and dimed every single day. And, you know, in regards to the legality of it, you know, we vote on many issues here in the council. That's on a side note, where we don't have the legal authority to vote on. And there's a number of bills I can name you and that we have voted on in the past that we had no legal authority. But this amendment will show equity to all New Yorkers and all hardworking New Yorkers. And I support this amendment, and I have to fight for my constituents here in the city of New York. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Parliamentarian. Is anyone else slated to speak?
Yes, Mr. Public Advocate. Councilmember Van Bramer would like to speak.
Councilmember Van Bramer.
Starting time.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to vote no on these amendments, but I do want to say that I appreciate these lively debates, and I may disagree with Councilmember Yeager, but you know, he referenced the fact that this is not the first time we've ever brought up a point of discussion or an amendment later in the process, and I think that's okay. We're all duly elected officials, and we're called on to debate important issues, and this is an important one, and Councilmember Yeager wants to bring it up. I think that's his right. All of us then are duly elected officials and have to make the best decision with the information that we're provided with. So I'm not offended by Coleman bringing this up at all, and I think he has every right to do so. Again, I'm voting no and going to disagree with him, but you know, I actually think the council is at its best when we have debate and we actually have discussion and we talk about the things that we agree with and disagree with. And this is part of the process. And I wish we did more of it, quite frankly. So while I'm voting no, I just want to say I don't resent Coleman Yeager for introducing this and asking us to take up a contentious issue. That's what we do as legislators. We all fought to be here. We should be able to take votes and own our votes.
Thank you, Councilmember. Mr. Parliamentarian, has anyone else signed up to speak?
No, Mr. Public Advocate. No other council members wish to speak at this time. At this point,
I do actually want to take a point of a personal privilege to speak. I'll be speaking, obviously, as one of the sponsors of the bill, and also one of four council members who signed on an amicus brief to try to force this mayor to deal with some of the issues that Councilmember Yeager brought up. I also have to acknowledge that I don't have the weight of a vote that everyone else will. As Councilmember Van Bramer said, I think lively debate is good for any legislature. I think this has been something that's been debated for a very long time. Maybe this will help push folks forward to actually deal with this. So I want to make sure I say that first. But I do have to say, I spent a lot of time negotiating this bill. I don't know the things that Councilmember Chin went through negotiating her bill. I imagine it was the same or even more. And we are faced at a time right now, just right now today, where a confluence of things are happening. We're about to pass a budget. We're trying to maintain services, and we're trying to provide relief for people who need it. And I know for my bill, and I assume it's for the same for Councilmember Chin, it was about making sure we can get the taxes for the services that we need while narrowly focusing on the people who just can't pay. Doesn't matter, whatever you say, if you can't pay it, you can't pay it. Because you've been affected by COVID, we wanted to make sure that there was relief. Both of these bills provide that relief. And I understand that at least for Councilmember Chin's bill, the recommendation to try to get it even lower. I think that is noble and stuff that we should discuss, but I think it's tough to do just on today without having the knowing the impact that will happen. We have negotiated these bills knowing the impact that will occur based on what based on what we presented today. Given where we are on the budget, given the relief that's needed now, and given that we're trying to find a sweet spot of getting tax revenue for the services and providing the relief, my hope is that we will support the bills as they are and vote no on these amendments. And I would encourage Councilmember Yeager to put these in as LS as soon as possible. And hopefully the body can take up those LS and really push this debate forward because it is an important one to have. With that, I thank everyone for this lively debate. Mr. Parliamentarian, I know you're going to provide some instruction.
Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. There has been a request from a council member for a point of parliamentary order. The meeting will stand at ease.
Thank you.
Mr. Public Advocate.
Yes.
The meeting will resume.
Thank you.
At this point, we will now take a roll call vote of concerning all four amendments.
We lost you for a second, so can you just repeat that?
At this point, we will take a roll call vote on Councilmember Yeager's four amendments. We will conduct the roll call vote as we do for general orders, in which we will consider all four bills in one roll call vote. If members wish to vote differently on any of the four votes, you can say, I vote aye, with the exception of the amendment on resolution 1347, or however you would like to split your vote. But we will now take a roll call vote on just the four amendments that Councilmember Yeager has proposed on the floor. At the conclusion of the vote, the clerk will announce the results of the vote, and we will give more information to the council members on where we stand. As a reminder, at the conclusion of all the voting and the parliamentary procedure regarding these four amendments, we are still in discussion of general orders, and there are additional members who wish to speak about general orders before we take a vote on the underlying bills for general orders. So as a last point of clarification, right now we are only voting on Councilmember Yeager's four proposed amendments. A vote aye means a vote in favor of the amendment. A vote nay is a vote against the four proposed amendments that Councilmember Yeager has proposed. With that, Mr. Public Advocate, please call on the clerk to take a roll call vote on the proposed amendments.
Thank you. Asking the clerk to take a roll call vote on solely Council Members Yeager's four amendments.
Adams.
Permission to explain my vote.
Permission granted.
Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. I, of course, have to say to my colleague, Council Member Yeager, these amendments are so thoughtful and I appreciate them. I appreciate the debate that we just had with regard to these amendments. You've given me a lot to think about. I took a lot of umbrage with our colleagues who expressed that this has been debated for years. And I would have loved to have debated this in committee, and I still want to debate this out even more, because I just think that these amendments are so very thoughtful. I'm just not prepared to give an affirmative on them yet. I think that we all have to come back to the table and talk about it, hash it all out, see where we would be if we were to say yes to these amendments and the effect that it would have overall on the city and the condition that we are in right now as a city. So with that said, thank you, Councilmember Yeager, for these amendments. Respectfully, I will vote nay. Thank you.
MP Samuel.
Permission to explain my vote.
Permission granted.
Start in time.
Very similar to my colleague, Councilmember Adams, I do want to say to Councilmember Yeager, I 100% appreciate the discussion. And I must, and honestly, as I was sitting here, I haven't had this level of quick research and analysis of the law since law school, in all honesty. I have sat here at this computer going back and forth and texting with colleagues, and I appreciate that, and I appreciate you. But because of where we are right now, in the middle of COVID and what we are trying to accomplish right now, I look forward to this debate in DEM conference again, but right now I would have to vote no, but thank you.
Ayala.
No.
Barron.
Permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Starting time.
I'm voting no on the amendment, but as my colleagues before have said, this is an issue that we have to stop kicking down the curb. We've talked at it. We've had some presentations from finance about what would be the impact of restructuring that. But this is a call for us to take action definitively and bring some equity to the inequity that we see. I'm voting no, but we need to address this issue. Thank you.
Borelli.
Aye at all.
Brennan.
But hey, permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Starts now.
The first few months of 2020, I think, saw us taking some of the most promising steps in decades towards finally fixing our totally unfair property tax system that puts all the burden on the working and middle class in the outer boroughs. And then COVID hit, and now everything is on hold once again. So I think given that the city's only mechanism for raising revenue is going to be through property taxes, I don't know how much more urgent it could be to ensure that the taxes are done in a way that's fair and truly reflective of people's values. I was not prepared to vote on these amendments, did not know these amendments were coming up, but now that they've been brought to the floor, I don't see how I could vote against them. So I'm voting in favor of them, aye on all.
Cabrera.
Permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
I'll make it very brief. I want to share the same sentiments shared by my colleagues, Barron, Adams, and Amprin Samuel, regarding the importance of this level of discussion. And I'm looking forward, Councilmember Yeager. I know it's coming from a really good place. Regarding this issue that has been plaguing us for years. I think Councilmember Chin and Jermani Williams, it's a step forward, but it's not the end. So with that, I'll be voting no, but I will be, would like to be up in front with you and with my colleagues to making sure that we keep moving to the next step. There's a next step that needs to take place. And with, thank you so much, Mr. Public Advocate.
Thank you.
Chen.
I vote no, and I hope that my colleagues will continue to work on this issue. Thank you.
Cohen. Deutsch.
Permission to explain my votes.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Thank you. So I've been hearing from my colleagues how this should have been discussed at a hearing. It should have been discussed this morning at the finance vote. But I have to say and be very honest that I applaud Councilmember Yeager for bringing this up at the stating meeting. And only to prove the fact that now it's getting some attention is that I'm watching all my colleagues during the state aid, and no one's eating lunch but paying attention to help all New Yorkers and all those that need this type of relief. So with that, I'm voting aye on this amendment. And I want to thank all my colleagues for paying attention to this issue. Thank you.
Diaz.
Permission to split my vote.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and all of you for this opportunity. And I would like to congratulate Council Member Yeager for bringing this issue to the floor. By the way, some McCarthy used the word responsible to bring when addressing the issue, when he said that to bring this to the floor is it could be irresponsible. I mean, when are we going to tell the homeowners, the middle class, that we are really, really fighting for them? This is the opportunity. This is the time. All the people saying, oh, it's not illegal. We got to go to the court. I mean, my concern is to send a message to all the homeowners in District 18 and throughout the city that this council member is protecting their interests and their finances. And I'm voting yes or no. Thank you.
Drum.
I vote no.
Eugene.
I vote no.
Gibson.
Permission to explain?
Sorry, I was on mute. Permission granted.
Time starts
now. Thank you. No, I'll be quick. I appreciate all of my colleagues speaking up, particularly about such an important issue where we know that many homeowners and property owners are struggling, have been struggling, and will continue to struggle. I think this is a conversation that we must continue to have, particularly many of us who represent outer boroughs where the burden has always been placed on them. Their properties are valued at a different assessment level and they continue to pay higher taxes, and that simply has never been fair. But for the purposes of today's conversation, I want to echo the sentiments expressed by Councilmember Adams and Councilmember Amfrey Samuel as we continue to talk about this important issue. I will be voting no on today's amendments and want to thank Councilmember Yeager for bringing the issue up. Thank you.
Jonai.
Permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Thank you, Public Advocate. We heard a lot from our members, and obviously there's a concern, and these are trying times spiritually on all of us. We're going to be judged by how we vote on this amendments that have been put forth by Councilman Yeager. And I want to remind everyone that if we don't do this and stand up today with one voice, the next time we can revisit this will be 1 year from now. I have no idea what this new world is going to look like. I don't know what next month is going to look like. I have no idea what this budget is going to look like. I am not ready to throw my homeowners under the bus again in their most time of need and crisis. I'm going to support these the motions that were put forth by Yeager with the understanding that these are difficult times on all of us, but we will not be able to revisit this for another year. So I vote aye.
Gordonchik.
No.
Holden.
Permission to briefly explain my vote.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
The mayor's office text to the members during this debate confirms that the middle class property tax and the interest penalty is the cash cow of this city. So enough is enough. Strike one for the middle class here. I want to thank Councilman Yeager for this amendment. And I vote aye on all.
Kalos.
Permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
this council is responsible for convening a New York City Advisory Commission on Property Tax Reform that issued a preliminary report back in January with a host of 10 different recommendations aimed at trying to level the playing field. In particular, one of the recommendations would have been particularly helpful to those in co-ops and condos, many of which live in my district, along with many others across the city, as well as trying to scale up and level off the taxes for the entire city and trying to create something that was more equitable and sought after. The public hearing schedule was about to begin when this pandemic hit. And I think that that is the correct process. It is a process that would involve the city and the state. And I do support that. And I want to see that peace process move forward. And I would encourage all of my colleagues who are talking about trying to support the middle class to fully engage the Property Tax Reform Commission, and that we demand that this move forward and start taking testimony through online. And that being said, I vote no on all.
Cohen.
Permission to explain my vote briefly?
Permission granted.
Okay.
Thank you very much. While I certainly respect my colleague's right to bring the motion to the floor, I really don't think this is the appropriate forum in which we could hash this out and have a discussion based on facts and come to a decision based on facts. I would need more information. So for that reason, I'm going to vote no on the amendment today. Thank you.
King.
I don't know.
Ku.
Mr. Public Advocate, may I explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Thank you. Yeah. So I think today we have the, for the first time, we can speak on behalf on all the small property owners. You know, many people in my district own apartments, small co-ops, condominiums, and they always complain to me the tax is too high because they live on fixed income, especially when you retire. But the property tax keep increasing every year. Today, the folks are not talking about, we're not talking about property tax. The tax is too high. Today we are talking about the interest rate if you don't pay for the property tax. So this is the first step we show to our middle class property owners. And they are not rich people. They are retired teachers, right? They are retired workers and they are on limited income. So at least we show them the first step that we are listening. We are trying to help them. This is the first step to lower the interest rate if they don't pay. And later on, we had to decrease the property tax rates. We had to find a forum on how to decrease it because this has been increasing every year, year by year. After 20 years, you pay almost double. And people's salary is not going double. So with all that said, I vote to support the amendments.
Kozlowicz.
May I be excused to explain my vote? Why?
Permission granted.
Starts now.
While I do not want to throw my constituents or any constituents under the bus by taxes, right now we are going through a $9 billion budget deficit, fighting for the services for these people that we are talking about today. And I want to get through that. I want to revisit this again. And I feel that we have to revisit it and we're going for it. I vote no.
Lantman.
No.
Lander.
No.
Levin.
No.
Levine.
I vote no.
Lewis.
Permission to explain my vote?
Commissioner Granite.
Time starts now.
Thank you. I appreciate you, Councilmember Yeager, for bringing this to my attention earlier and for your leadership and your advocacy and just helping us to explain, to understand this process. I agree with the bills as is in regards to Councilmember Chin and Public Advocates Williams' bill. Everything else is a bit convoluted, but I hope we can have a larger discussion and debate about this. For right now, I'm gonna vote no on this amendment. I hope we can have a larger conversation later. Thank you.
Mizell.
No.
Menchaca.
Permission to explain my vote.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
I want to also extend thank you to my colleague from Brooklyn, Councilmember Yeager, for this lively debate. I think, you know, debates happen when they happen, and they're happening now, and I approve of that. I also am very curious about how the impact will be, or what the full impact will be, which means that a yes vote actually gets us to another week into the next stated when we can actually vote on the new amendment. And so because of that, I'm going to vote yes on your amendments in favor of continuing this conversation so that we can have a more robust discussion. And thank you to the mayor for messaging me. And my message to you is defund the NYPD and reallocate those funds to communities of color and communities impacted by COVID. Thank you.
Miller.
Permission to explain?
Briefly. Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Okay, again, we find ourselves advocating on behalf of homeowners and those people who are critical to the city's tax bases. This is a conversation that is not new. Many of our colleagues, some that were in the council when this conversation began a number of years back, which is why we have the Reform Commission. That was mentioned by Councilmember Kalos, and we had continued to address that. And we understand that this is certainly disproportionate and that this is a separate issue on penalties. It is certainly time to move forward on this. I think I commend all of the thoughtful discourse that has happened today, but I want to commend especially the members who introduced this legislation, who thought it was important enough to, in a very responsible way, reduce the penalties for homeowners, at the same time ensure that we can provide services in the time of COVID-19. Many of us whose communities have been ravaged, who have benefited by the essential services that have been provided and the additional services that have been provided, this has been absolutely important. So with that, I will be voting no.
Moya.
No.
Perkins.
Yes.
Powers.
Permission to briefly explain my vote.
Permission granted.
Time starts.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate. I want to thank Councilmember Yeager for bringing this to the floor and bringing it to conversation to the body today, because it's something we've discussed for the last 3 years while I've been in the council, at least. I'm not sure about before that. And I know it's something him and many other members feel deeply about in terms of helping out their constituents and property owners in the outer boroughs in particular. I am concerned about the finances of the city right now. I'm concerned about changing without having a fiscal impact, without understanding what it would do in terms of our property tax revenues being collected and how it affects services, so forth and so on. So I am voting against the amendment. But I do appreciate all the debate and hearing everybody's thoughts on it. It was very helpful to me. But I do think we, in a fiscal crisis, have to be careful about how we impact the city's revenues going forward and concerned about the impact on people paying. So thank you. I'm voting against.
Reynoso.
Permission to explain my vote, Public Advocate.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Thank you. I just want to put in perspective the fact that this debate that we're having right now is not necessarily one of people that support small homeowners and people that don't. The legislation doesn't do either of that. I think it's an attempt here to have a larger conversation about property tax reform, which I do think is a valid conversation to have. I just don't think that these bills are necessarily contradictory to that work. I just don't think this was the appropriate time to have this debate. I think we should have had this debate a long time ago. We do offer council members opportunities in subcommittees and committees to really talk about this extensively. And if the said council member didn't take the time to do that, I feel like this is more of a performance than it is actual want to help people. So I'm going to be voting no against this on all.
Richards.
No.
Rivera.
Thank you so much. I do hope that at some point soon we spend this amount of time talking about tenant relief as well. And with that, I vote no on all.
Rodriguez.
I also believe that as we're taking the time to discuss this proposal, we also pay all the attention to be sure that as we look at consequences, all council members and the speaker and the administration focus on working on this budget, focus on an anti-poverty initiative so that we can get prepared to another type of coronavirus. Or with that, I vote no.
Rose.
Permission to explain my vote.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Usually when we talk about property tax bills, I vote with my colleagues, Jaeger and my fellow Staten Island delegation, because I happen to represent a district that is disproportionately taxed and have been negatively impacted by the disparities in the tax law. And so this is very difficult for me because my homeowners are being unfairly taxed, and the interest rates are unfair. But I have to, being on the budget and negotiating team, I am keenly aware of the state of our budget. And so it makes it very difficult to vote in a manner that I think is now fiscally irresponsible, that would help all of us, the entire city, get through the other side of the COVID pandemic. So because of that, I am going to vote no, but I am going to strongly, and I am going to support Councilmember Jaeger as vociferously as I can to ensure that this issue does not wind up on the back burner, and that we do address it, because it is far, far too long that we continue to impact the outer boroughs disproportionately. So I vote no on all, but reluctantly. Thank you.
Rosenthal.
No.
Salamanca.
No.
Torres. Traeger.
Permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Thank you, public advocate. I think it goes without question that there is a need, an urgency, to look at equity and fairness in the property tax system. But there is no way you can have an honest conversation about property tax if you do not discuss New York State government's role and the federal government's role. Why is there such a reliance on local taxes? Let's look at the fact that as of this moment, Washington, D.C., has appropriated zero to local and state aid in the middle of a pandemic and fiscal crisis. The last time I checked, many homeowners are also teachers, nurses, bus drivers, and other critical essential workers whose jobs are on the line right now. And the last time I checked, New York State still owes our schools over $1 billion. New York State is on the verge of cutting an additional $2 billion to New York City. Ask hospitals in my borough, Brooklyn, if they're getting their fair share from Albany. Ask hospitals in Queens, are they getting their fair share from Albany? The answer is no. And so yes, we need fairness and justice and property taxes, but let's have an honest conversation how New York State and Washington DC continuously fail the people of our city. And that is why I vote no on this amendment.
Ulrich.
Just wondering if this is a good time to bring up my no confidence vote. I'm just kidding. I'm voting yes on the amendments, and I think that the debate is great for the body, and it's great to see everybody's faces. Stay safe. I vote yes.
Vallone.
Permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Thank you. So when have we had this conversation? For those of us who are a little upset that we've gone off track, I don't know when we've had it. So it is time to talk about how we pay for things. It is time to figure out how we do finance this city and where the income comes from to create this great city. So yes, Kalman Yeager's amendments, again, should not have been done this way. And the only reason why that I'm voting no, but that will never happen again. And the next time we ever have, it has to be on the promise that we have this real conversation, because for anyone who doesn't think we need this conversation, then you're not listening. And everything we do, and every program we put forward, and everything we initiate has to be funded. And it can't always be funded on the backs of the middle class and homeowners. And today this crisis has just brought that to fruition. So yes, these, what we're voting on today, I vote with our speaker. I vote against, so I vote no on the resolutions and the amendments, but I only on the promise that we have real estate tax reform mentioned and where the funds are coming from, how those are distributed, and what communities they are going to. And for that, I say no on the resolutions.
Van Bramer.
Permission to briefly explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
So again, I appreciate Councilmember Yeager bringing this up. I actually love when we debate, even off the cuff. And I actually think that's when the council is at its best as a legislative body. So I appreciate Councilmember bringing this up, and I wish we did more of this debating style legislature. But I disagree with the amendment and will be voting no, but take no exception whatsoever to Kalman Yeager forcing us into debate. That's exactly what a legislature should do. With that, I vote no.
Yeager.
Mr. President, may I be excused to explain
permission
my vote?
Granted.
Time starts now.
Up there. I would first like to express my gratitude to Mr. Speaker and Mr. President for indulging and enabling in many ways this debate. And my gratitude, of course, to Mr. Public Advocate, yourself, and Councilmember Chin for advancing the two bills that are going to pass today with my support, notwithstanding the failure of this amendment, of these four amendments. I know that in this body, notwithstanding the fact that this amendment, these four amendments got a few votes and we know what the tally is, I know and I'm sensing the feeling amongst many members who did not vote yes, that this conversation has to happen. So for those who have somewhat of umbrage in the way that it's done, my apologies. I am grateful, and I'll mention one member, although some have alluded to this, Councilman Van Bramer, right before me, this is what we should be doing. We are paid to be legislators. We're not a rubber stamp, and we're not a community board. We're not the prompt city council. We are a legislature, and this is what we should be doing. I am so grateful that the speaker has allowed us to come to the floor and this conversation to happen, and Mr. President, you leading the debate. My friends, we can continue this conversation, not today, because it's almost over. And again, my apologies to those who plan to exit this meeting a little earlier. We have to do a little bit more for the workers. We do. And as Councilmember Rivera said, it's not just for one or the other. We have to help the tenants. We've been talking about that for the last several weeks. We have to help the tenants, but if the tenants don't pay rent, there is no property tax to pay. These problems are hand in hand, and the solution is hand in hand. With that, Mr. President, I vote aye on all, and I am grateful again. Thank you, sir.
Matteo.
I vote aye on all.
Cumbo.
Permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Thank you, Public Advocate Jumani Williams. I just want to say that when we really care about issues and issues are important to us, I believe it's important for us to be able to have the proper debate in the proper settings, such as the Democratic Conference, such as hearings, meetings within our delegations. These are opportunities for us to speak about issues that we care about with experts that can help us to answer questions. Everything is a checks and balance system. If we do one thing, we need the experts to also tell us how it impacts every other thing. What is the domino effect that it will have on our city so that we are making the most responsible decisions? If we really care about these issues, we need to make sure that we have these discussions in the proper forums. This type of forum doesn't give the members an opportunity to ask questions, to speak to financial experts, and in essence, time is the most valuable thing that we have right now, and we have to utilize it wisely. So there was an opportunity to bring this up in the hearing with finance, and it was not done so. So the challenge that I have with this, are we actually trying to get progress? Are we trying to create a change? Or are we trying to create political favoritism with the people that we represent or others or with colleagues or with the media or the press? It's critical that we make movements to make sure that we are actually achieving our goals, but not simply headlining issues that are not going to go anywhere without the proper information, impact, research, question, and debate. I vote no in terms of how these were brought to the floor. This didn't give us adequate time, energy, or resources to make the most informed decision. Thank you.
Speaker Johnson.
I vote no on all the amendments. Do we have a tally? Mr. Clerk?
Yes. Councilmember Yeager's motion stands at 13 in the affirmative and 34 in the negative.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk.
Are we continuing general orders now?
Correct. First, Mr. Public Advocate, please note as the presiding officer that the motion has failed.
Thank you. Yes, the motion has failed based on the numbers that the clerk just read.
Mr. Public Advocate, the next two speakers on discussion of general orders are Council Members Reynoso and Traeger.
Thank you very much.
To clarify as a parliamentary point of order before we move forward, because the amendments have failed, we are now on discussion of general orders. And when we vote on general orders, all four of the amendments have failed, and therefore the intro and the resolutions that you will be voting on, coupled on general orders, will be in their original form. Their original form. Thank you very much, Mr. Public Advocate. You can now recognize the remaining two speakers in discussion of general orders.
Thank you, Mr. Parliamentarian. And as I know, we are all simultaneously trying to feverishly change our schedules around. We'll continue with our general orders and call on Mr. Councilmember Reynoso and Councilmember Trigger.
Time starts now.
Councilmember Reynoso?
Yeah, I'm so sorry. Oh, I didn't know I was going next. I just wanted to say thank you to everyone that is going to be supporting the outdoor dining bill today. It was a very important work that was done by the city council in ensuring that we got to this in a timely fashion and not delayed it for small businesses. COVID has hit many of our communities very hard, and it's also hit small businesses very hard. And we finally got an opportunity to really think about street space and exactly how we can use it to help vulnerable populations, including our restaurants. We're also talking about thousands of people getting back to work. There's one block in Manhattan that has over 8 businesses that are going to rehire 360 people, or that have already rehired 360 people. And that's the conversation we need to be having. I'll end by saying this legislation also speaks to equity. We're not asking for people to spend a lot of money, hire lobbyists or architects to put forth a sidewalk cafe type of system. Instead, we're allowing for the neighborhoods of Brownsville, the Lower East Side, the Upper West Side, and South Bronx all have the exact same opportunity to put something in front of their restaurants. And it just speaks to equity and gives everybody an opportunity to have that experience. So again, I want to thank my colleagues that will vote yes. And I'm really excited to see this program continue. I've gone out there twice already, and it's been a great experience. I hope the rest of my colleagues can be supportive, both by supporting this bill, but also going out and supporting your local restaurant. Thank you very much. I just want to thank Speaker Corey Johnson. I always have a lot of crazy street ideas, and he took this one and ran with it. And I really appreciate his support of the work that I'm doing when it comes to rethinking streetscape and for his leadership on this issue.
Thank you. Councilmember Trigger.
Time starts now.
Thank you, Public Advocate. I wanted to actually, my explanation on my vote recently is very relevant to my general order remarks. I want to thank the leadership of my colleague, Councilmember Vanessa Gibson, for spearheading the funding tracker bill on COVID-19. I want to argue that, you know, Coney Island is not just a beach and boardwalk. It is not just the Wonder Wheel. Over 50,000 people call our neighborhood home. And we have the fifth highest death rate per capita in the entire city of New York. And we need to make sure that resources reach the most impacted communities like mine. And like Councilmember Gibson mentioned, there's precedent of this with the Sandy Tracker bill, making sure that resources flow to the hardest hit communities to make sure that our neighborhoods have adequate healthcare access, that every single school is a community school with all the integrated services that our children and families and our seniors need. So I just want to urge my colleagues to please vote yes on the funding tracker bill. Thank you very much, Mr. Public Advocate.
Thank you. Mr. Parliamentarian, do we have anyone else signed up?
No, we do not, Mr. Public Advocate.
Thank you. And just very briefly, you know, there's a lot of discussion about the bills. I did want an opportunity to discuss mine very quickly and thank people who helped work on it. As I mentioned, there was a delicate balancing act, the need to collect property tax payments, which is our biggest source of revenue, while extending economic relief to those who needed the most. These were negotiated well into the night. My bill simply defers July property tax payment to October, giving New Yorkers time to pay their liability with no interest applied. If property owners still struggle to make their payment by October, they can apply for a city property tax aid program, which provides an installment agreement. The property tax deferrals apply to residential properties with an assessed value, not a market value, but an assessed value of $250,000 or less, where the property is the owner's primary residence, property owners with a combined income of up to $150,000, property owners who have been adversely affected by COVID, including having been diagnosed with a family member diagnosed with COVID-19, experienced symptoms of COVID-19 and so medical diagnosis, and lost the primary source of income due to COVID-19 between March 7th and June 30th, which continued for at least 1 month. I think this strikes the right balance. And I do want to thank the mayor's office for helping come up with the necessary agreement, Noah Brick and Rebecca Chasen for the council's finance department, of course, Speaker Johnson and Chair Drum. And I'd also like to thank my staff, Director of Legislation, Casey Addison, Legislative Associates, Anika Michelle, Brandon Jordan, First Deputy Public Advocate, Nick Smith, Chief Deputy Public Advocate, Veronica Havies, and my entire policy division, and urge my colleagues to vote yes on this bill. Next, I believe I'm correct, Mr. Parliamentarian, but are we doing a report of special committees? Is that correct?
Yes, no. That's correct.
None. Thank
you. Reports of standing committees.
Report of the Committee on Consumer Affairs and Business Licensing, Intro 1957A, Outdoor Dining.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Finance, Intro 1952A, COVID-19 Funds Tracker.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Intro 1964A, Fiscal Interest Rate.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Intro 1974A, Interest Rate for Property Owners Affected by COVID-19.
Amended and coupled on general orders with a message of necessity.
Reconsidered Reso 1346 through 1350, Payment of Real Estate Taxes.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Preconsidered LU 664 and Reso 1351, 3415 Knox Place.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Governmental Operations, Intro 1950A, COVID-19 Task Force.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Housing and Buildings, Intro 1976, Short-Term Housing Rental Transactions.
Amended and coupled on general orders.
Report of the Committee on Transportation, Intros 1250A, 1264A, and 1266A, e-bikes and e-scooters.
Amended and coupled order, amended and coupled on general orders. And at this time, I'm asking the clerk to please take a roll call vote on all of the items coupled on today's general orders calendar.
Adam.
Aye.
Ampri Samuel.
I vote aye.
Ayala.
Aye.
Barron.
I vote aye.
Borelli.
I vote aye on all except preconsidered Rezos 1347, 1348, and 1349. Thank you very much.
Brennan.
I vote aye on all with the exception of 1347, 1348, and 1349.
Cabrera.
I want to congratulate all my colleagues on their bills, and I want to thank everyone who will be voting yes on the e-scooter and e-bikes. With that, I vote aye on all.
Mario.
I'm voting no on 1347, 1348,
and
1349.
Aye on the
rest. Chin. I vote aye on all. Thank you.
Cohen.
Thank you very much. Permission to explain my vote for a second?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
I just want to let everyone know I have an Article 11 preservation land use item on. And despite COVID, I did go and inspect the property, and I feel like this is a very good use of tax expenditure in trying to keep this building affordable and make necessary repairs that will make the life better for these tenants. So I urge everyone to vote aye. I'm going to vote no on Intro 1250A. and 1264A and I on everything. Thank you.
Deutsch.
No on 1250, 1264, 1266, 1964, and no on rezos 1347, 1348, 1349, and I in the rest.
Diaz.
I'm voting no on 1347, 1348, 1349, and yes on the rest.
Drum.
Yes, at all.
Eugene.
I vote yes.
Gibson.
Permission to explain?
Permission granted.
Time starts Thank you. Now.
Thank you so much. I will be voting aye on today's agenda, but I wanted to certainly speak to the package of bills related to the e-scooters and e-bikes. And recognizing as we continue to get out of COVID-19 and offering and really embracing other modes of transportation, certainly a district like mine in the Bronx could always use alternative modes, particularly for many residents and youth that need to get around and go to work, and certainly providing those transportation alternatives. I would hope that the sponsor, as well as my colleagues and I, have an opportunity during the pilot for the shared e-scooter legislation, that we work very closely with the New York City Department of Transportation as it relates to this pilot, as it begins, that provides for safety and protection for all users, safety measures, and making sure that everyone is safe in terms of protecting not only the user, but communities as well. What we don't wanna see is a proliferation of e-bikes and e-scooters all across the city of New York. Certainly we embrace new ideas, but I think as this pilot commences, it's important for us to work very closely with DOT to make sure whatever gaps in service and deficiencies that we are seeing, that we recognize it and we work with DOT as well as all stakeholders, transportation groups, environmentalist groups, and really make sure that the pilot can be successful. And if we identify any issues, I would hope that amendments could be made as we see fit moving along. So I will be voting aye on today's agenda and want to thank all of my colleagues for a very spirited debate today on a number of bills on today's agenda. And thank you, Councilmember Cabrera, for bringing these bills to the floor and certainly looking forward to the continued work ahead. Thank you so much.
Jonai.
Permission to briefly explain my vote.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
I'm looking forward to being a part of the conversation with the pilot programs in around 1250 and 1266. Everything that was mentioned by my colleagues earlier, including not only safety, but proper storage. What my concern is that we will have scooters in our corridors and in our residential blocks that will be more of a hurdle and perhaps a obstacle to our pedestrians. But I'm looking forward to helping fix and adjust that to a permanent solution as we do in the future. I'll be voting aye on all except 1347, 1348, and 1349.
Gordonczyk.
Briefly explain my vote, Mr. Public Advocate.
Permission granted.
I'm sorry. Thank you
very much. I'm eye on all, but I am looking forward to the scooters because, you know, my district perhaps, more than any other in the city of New York is transit starved. We don't have Long Island Railroad. We don't have the subway, and mass transit in my district is essentially two people in the car. So, I think the scooters should be interesting and I'm looking forward to seeing how that works out. I want to congratulate, the sponsor of the legislation. And with that, I vote aye on all. Thank you, Mr. Public Advocate.
Thank you.
Holden.
I vote aye on all with the exception of intros 1250, 1264, 1266, and rezos 1347, 1348, 1349, of which I vote no. Thank you.
Kalos.
Aye on all.
King.
Aye on all except 1347, 1348, 1349, 1258, and 1266A.
Koo.
I'm voting no on intro 1266A, resolution 1347, 1348, 1349. And I will aye on the rest of it. Thank you.
Kozlowitz.
Aye on all.
Lantzman.
Can I briefly explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
I'm going to vote no on 1250 and 1266 relating to the e-scooters. I'm just concerned that there are important safety issues for both riders and pedestrians that haven't been resolved. We are reimagining how our streetscape is going to look and operate. And I think we need to do that deliberately. So I wish that we were talking about maybe a modest pilot in terms of the public's ability to use e-scooters, but going from 0 to 60, if you don't mind the transit metaphor, is a little too much for me. So no on 1250 and 1266, and yes on everything else. Thank you.
Lander.
Request permission to explain.
Permission granted.
Time starts now. Advocate.
I vote aye on all, and I'm especially enthusiastic about Councilmember Reynoso's bill for open streets. I've also been eating out most every night. But I do want to say I remain disappointed that the delivery workers that work for those restaurants still don't get a single paid day off when they're sick. And that while we are handing open space, free public space over to restaurants like Chipotle and McDonald's and other fast food restaurants, but we're not protecting their workers from unfair firings for speaking up about COVID conditions. We could do both those things. We have legislation in the Essential Worker and Fast Food Worker Bill of Rights. And I really hope we will take them up. I wish we were doing those today along with Councilmember Reynoso's bill. And then I also want to say, you know, I'm sorry we're not at City Hall today, because if we were, we would be hearing right outside us the voices of the people who are out there speaking up loud and clear about what they really want us to be debating in this body, demanding that we fight to defund the NYPD by at least $1 billion and repurpose that money to protect education and youth services and social services, especially in Black and brown neighborhoods. I like when this body is used to debate, and we want to have robust debate. But let's have the debate on the things that the people are calling for, on the things that the people are out in the streets for. I know we're finalizing that budget, and we'll have a subsequent meeting to get it done. But boy, if we're going to raise up our voices here and spend our time debating, let's do it on the things that are most urgent in our city. I vote aye on all. Thank you.
Levin.
With particular gratitude to Council Members Cabrera, Reynoso, Chin, and the Public Advocate on their very thoughtful and thorough legislation today, and thanks to the Speaker and staff for shepherding them through, I want to happily vote aye on all. Thank you.
Levine.
Yes, with congrats to all the sponsors, I will be voting aye on all.
Lewis.
I don't know.
Mizell.
Yes.
Menchaca.
Permission to explain my vote.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Voting aye on all except for 1250 and 1266. I already made my comments in the general discussion, but I feel like the work that we are doing around immigrant delivery workers are where our energy needs to be placed. And I'm glad that Councilmember Lander invoked the Occupy work that's happening right now, or the occupying that's happening right now outside of City Hall. They are demanding us that we have these debates happening at the exact same time. Antonio Reynoso and I were at a police-free schools rally where the youth are asking us to remove the police from the police from schools. That's a debate that I'm ready to have, and I hope we can have that as soon as possible. Thank you so much, and I vote aye on all except for 1250, 1266.
Miller.
I vote aye with the exception of 1266A.
Sorry, Councilman, what was the first one you said?
Aye with the exception of 1266A. I vote.
Thank you. My apologies.
Okay.
Moya.
I vote aye on all with the exception of 1250 and 1266.
Perkins.
I have to say it over.
Did you hear me?
Yes, Councilmember Perkins.
Thank you very much. Aye on all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Powers.
Aye on all.
Reynoso.
Permission to explain my vote.
Permission granted.
I just wanted to speak to the concerns we have over the impact that e-scooters has related to a lifeline or lifetime. We're concerned that many of them go to landfills and have a short or very short lifespan. I think we should follow up that conversation with legislation that reports back to us exactly where these scooters go to die. I think it's important for our long-term climate change conversation and we shouldn't ignore it. But I think that that should happen after this vote. So I'm voting aye on all and want to just congratulate Councilmember Cabrera and all of the councilmembers that have been pushing for this for a long time. Good job, aye on all.
Richards.
Hey, I'm going to vote aye on all. And I also just want to add that I know that the mayor's folks are listening around this conversation on property taxes. I'm hoping that we're going to see them double down in this budget by ensuring that foreclosure assistance funds are there for homeowners as well. And that we're seeing more resources certainly pumped into these specific areas as well as we negotiate this budget. So I do agree with Calman specifically on the need to have this conversation, which we've been having now for 6 years. I was a part of that amicus brief. So I'm hoping that this budget will reflect the values and prioritize homeowners as well. Thank you. With that, I'm voting aye.
Rivera.
Congratulations to my colleagues. I vote aye on all.
Rodriguez. Councilmember Rodriguez. I'll come back, Councilmember. Councilmember Rose.
Aye on all.
Rosenthal.
Permission to explain my vote quickly.
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Thank you. I'm going to vote aye on all, but I am very hesitant about 1250A in particular. Some of my other colleagues have talked about the issues around safety and the issue around climate. And frankly, other localities have repealed legislation about scooters. So legislation allowing scooters. So I'm going to be keeping my eye on the scooter issue. And similarly, I think on the Upper West Side, we see a lot of e-bikes and frankly scooters going the wrong way on bike lanes and in the park, like along the Greenway and Riverside Park, going the wrong way, and have quite a few constituents who have been in crashes with those e-bikes and have gotten seriously injured. But for a variety of reasons, I'm still voting yes on them. What I would ask is that we think hard about how we keep people safe with the e-bikes and the scooters. And what I'm learning from the Black Lives Matter movement is to look at all of our city systems and think about how they're designed and how they intersect with law enforcement. Environmentally, we want to encourage alternative forms of transportation. I believe DOT could do a lot more in terms of ensuring biking is safe for all bikers, regardless of race or immigration status, and understanding that the PD, you know, their facial recognition cameras aren't the only transportation enforcement strategy. We need to get creative. Thank you very much.
The clerk.
My apologies. Salamanca.
Ayano.
Torres. Rodriguez. Traeger.
Permission to explain my vote?
Permission granted.
Time starts now.
Thank you, public advocates. So I want to commend Councilmember Reynoso, Speaker Johnson, also Councilmember Powers, who have been very forceful, passionate in the outdoor dining accommodations for restaurants and businesses. In my district, we don't have any of the open streets, but we do have our boardwalk. And as the city is waiving fees and certain making accommodations, to businesses in the Open Streets program, they've made no such accommodations for concessions and businesses on the boardwalk to have outdoor activities and outdoor dining. So I am insisting that the administration provide the same accommodations, the same waiving of fees that they've done for businesses in neighborhoods to the businesses in Coney Island and Brighton Beach, who are really going through a lot right now as well. And with that, I vote aye.
Ulrich.
Good afternoon. I am voting aye on all with the exception of intros 1347, 1348, 1349, and also 1976, and aye on all others.
Ballone.
Aye on all.
Van Bramer.
With a great appreciation for Councilmember Reynoso's bill, which I hope will permanently transform the way our streets work, I vote aye on all.
Jaeger.
Mr. President, may I be excused to explain my vote briefly?
Commissioner Granite.
Time starts now.
I've had the microphone a little bit today. First, again, my thanks to Mr. Speaker and Public Act President for enabling and facilitating a very lively, important debate. And again, to those members whose time has been consumed by this, my gratitude for your indulgence. My apologies if I messed up your schedule. Not my intent at all. And whichever way you voted, I know you care about New Yorkers, and I am very grateful to all my colleagues for their work, or most of you. I will be voting aye on all, with the exception of resolutions 1347, 1348, 1349, and introductions 1250, 1264, 1266, 1950. Thank you, Mr. President.
Ulrich. I apologize. After the resolutions,
Introductions?
Yes, please.
Okay. Go on introductions 1250, 1264, 1266, 1250.
Thank you. Combo.
I vote aye on all.
Rodriguez.
Aye.
Thank you. Torres. Speaker Johnson.
I vote aye on all.
Okay. The vote on all items for today's general order calendar is 47 in the affirmative, 0 in the negative, and no abstentions, with the exceptions of the following: resolutions 1347, 1348, and 1349 have 36 in the affirmative, 11 in the negative, no abstentions. Introduction 1250A, 40 in the affirmative, 7 in the negative, no abstentions. Introduction 1264A with 41 in the affirmative, 6 in the negative, 0 abstentions. Introduction 1266A with 39 in the affirmative, 8 in the negative, 0 abstentions. And introduction 1964A with 45 in the affirmative, 2 in the negative, and no abstentions.
Thank you very much. The items on today's general order calendars are adopted. Introduction and reading of bills.
All bills have been referred to committees as indicated on today's agenda.
Thank you. There are no resolutions on today's calendar, so we will now move into general discussion. As a reminder, please wait until the Sergeant at Arms has begun the countdown clock before you begin your remarks. And I'll ask the parliamentarian if anyone has signed up for general order.
Yes, Mr. Public Advocate, Council Members Ku, Rivera, Menchaca, and Majority Leader Cumbo have signed up for general order.
Rivera, Menchaca, and Majority Leader Cumbo.
Correct.
Thank you. Council Member Ku.
Time starts now.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker and Mr. Public Advocate. Today marks the 70th anniversary of the beginning of the Korean War. I would like to take this moment to offer my thanks to the many Korean War veterans in my district and here in New York City. The United States and South Korea continue to remain great allies thanks to the many sacrifices of our veterans. And we are all eternally grateful for their contributions to peace. I would also like to say that I'm very pleased that we are finally beginning the phase two reopening. I believe we will all see in the coming months how difficult it will be for our local businesses to get back on their feet. Now is the time for the City Council to focus on how to jumpstart our economy and help small businesses. We need to start looking at how to implement a moratorium on property tax increase in order to provide relief where our business and our homeowners are being hit hardest. We also must not let quality of life issues be ignored. We need to continue cleaning up our streets, move the homeless into shelters, ensure our sidewalks are free from debris and illegal vending, and create real solutions to to help the small businesses who make up the bricks and mortar of our city. If we can do that, we can restore the people's faith in government. Thank you.
Councilmember Rivera.
Time starts now.
Thank you so much, everyone. We all know that the social justice movement has always included the belief that housing is a human right. And as we continue to debate our next budget and the need to transfer funding from police to social services and our neighborhood programs, we must ensure that part of that discussion involves community-led development. In the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic, our city is now dealing with two new fronts in the housing crisis: a newly unstable real estate market vulnerable to exploitation from predatory interests, and the onslaught of expected evictions as online legal proceedings resumed this week. We know these moments of crisis can allow speculators to easily swoop in and increase gentrification in our neighborhoods. We saw this in 2001 and 2008, and we cannot allow that to happen again. That's why this morning I held a rally with a diverse group of housing advocates to call for funding for critical housing initiatives in the city budget, including the citywide CLT initiative and the Stabilizing NYC initiative. We also called for the restoration of the HPD capital budget. Beyond the budget, our rally drew attention to Intro 1977, a new piece of legislation I'm introducing with Councilmember Reynoso that would give affordable housing developers and communities an equal opportunity to compete and purchase new property in the hyper-competitive New York City real estate market. Intro 1977, which we call the Community Opportunity to Purchase Act, or COPA, will give nonprofit affordable housing developers, community land trusts, and other organizations a right of first refusal whenever landlords decide to sell apartment buildings or property. COPA provides those seeking to develop or retain affordable housing the opportunity and the time to present property owners with a competitive offer. In a market such as the one we are in today, that can be increasingly difficult, particularly with private equity firms and real estate vultures ready and waiting to make offers in just a few days. It's important we pass this bill to protect and provide those
in housing
an equal shot to improve and continue their community development. I hope my colleagues will join me this week in supporting Intro 1977 and supporting the pillars of a fair community and affordable housing plan in our budget. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Machaca.
Time starts now.
Councilman Machaca, you still there?
Yep. Can you hear me now?
We can hear you.
Okay. As the COVID-19 pandemic raged across New York City, we saw a spike in deaths across the five boroughs. Families were scrambling to find resources and information to help bury their loved ones, and on top of an unprecedented economic and health crisis. However, the mayor's office was totally unprepared. Council offices were suddenly flooded with calls and requests to help bring dignity to family members who had suddenly passed. But getting information from the mayor's office was nearly impossible and turned into a blame game. The mayor's office pointed to the finger of the state, who then pointed the finger to the federal government, who then pointed it back to the mayor. And as usual, it was immigrant New Yorkers who suffered the most from this incompetence. We have seen the importance of consolidating city services in 311, and we should continue to do that. However, in a pandemic where mass casualties are inevitable, the city must ensure that we are supporting families by communicating immediately that the latest information dealing with what the information is about the borough services. For example, the most New Yorkers had no idea that the chief medical examiner was helping overwhelmed hospitals and funeral homes by operating long-term refrigeration to preserve bodies. Most New Yorkers also did not know that a 15-day deadline to claim bodies had been lifted. Had these things been communicated quickly and in multiple languages, hundreds of families, particularly immigrant families, would have been spared weeks of heart-wrenching grief and stress. Speaking of which, while 311 has become an indispensable hotline during the pandemic, 311 operators are not trained to speak with someone or help them cope when they are experiencing the trauma of losing a loved one. We should create a separate hotline with trained professionals from New York for New Yorkers to get burial assistance. The legislation I'm introducing today will do all of this. It will ensure that during an emergency, New Yorkers will never compound their trauma of losing a loved one
and
failing to take care of them. Considering we could see a spike in cases as we reopen, this bill is critical and must be prioritized. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. And Majority Leader Kumbo.
Time starts now.
I yield my time.
Thank you, Majority Leader.
Mr. Public Advocate, the meeting will stand at ease for 1 minute.
Okay.
Did you want to say anything before you were going to turn it over to the speaker?
I'm going to say something, but okay, I was also asking if anyone has signed up.
No one else has signed up. You're welcome to make your remarks while we check on one issue before we can close the meeting.
Okay, thank you. I was just going to say on April 1st or thereabouts, my office put out a report on how to respond and recover to COVID. We had a few ideas. I'm proud that one of them was passed today in 1964. I want to thank my colleagues for that. There are a couple of other pieces of legislation that were put in today. I'm looking forward to working with my colleagues to addressing that as well. I also just wanted to say congratulations to all folks who had bills today and all the colleagues who were on the ballot this past Tuesday. All of us know the difficulty of putting our names out there and having grueling campaigns. So congratulations to everyone who tried it. And a special shout out to Councilmember Richards and Torres, who had pretty good nights on Tuesday. Thank you. And I guess the meeting will stand at ease, parliamentarian.
Yes, Mr. Public Advocate, for just a few more moments. Mr. Public Advocate.
Yes.
Please recognize the clerk who has an updated vote tally.
I'd like to recognize the clerk.
Quick revision, thank you. Introduction 1976 had a vote of 46 in the affirmative, 1 in the negative, and no abstentions. And introduction 1958 had a vote of 46 in the affirmative, 1 in the negative, and no abstentions as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Parliamentarian. Can we move forward now?
One moment, please, Mr. Public Advocate.
Sure.
Mr. Public Advocate, we can resume the meeting and you can turn it over to the speaker.
Thank you very much. We had a spirited meeting. I want to thank the speaker for helping get us through this as well. And you, Mr. Parliamentarian. With that, I'll call on Speaker Corey Johnson to close today's stated meeting.
The stated meeting of June 25th. I think Councilmember Barron, did you want to speak? Okay, so let's call on Councilmember Barron and then we'll wrap the meeting up. Go ahead, Councilmember Barron.
Time starts now.
You're on mute, Councilman Barron. Still on mute.
You're on mute.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, good. Thank you so much. And thank you to the staff for helping to try to help me navigate through all this technology. I just want to use this forum to call to the mayor's attention the need to continue to fund ASAP, which is a program that has been nationally acclaimed, that has twice the graduation rate of other programs, where students have been able to make positive contributions based on the support that they get through the ASAP program. The mayor's talking about not having a class this September, so I'm using this forum to let the mayor know that that's a very critical issue. But I also want to use this time to respond to an article that was in today's Daily News, which said that statute debate is becoming downright dumb. And it describes the actions of our council to have that statue removed as a sudden decision. Well, for the writer to think that this was sudden, it's indicative of how out of touch, how uninformed, and how far removed he is from the grassroots people and what it is that they want. This is not an impulsive response to the massive demonstrations that are calling for racial justice. In fact, any cursory investigative researcher would have found that this issue of the insult of the presence of the statue goes back more than a decade, when the issue was raised by my husband, Assembly Member Barron, who was then the council member. And the documents which the writer referenced in his article that he feels are so supportive of Thomas Jefferson being a great person refers to the Declaration of Independence, which refers to Native Americans as Indian savages, the Constitution, which has a 3/5 clause as relates to Black Americans, and his letter referencing Jefferson's wall of separation between the church and state doesn't talk about the life that he lived that demonstrated a wall of denial of the basic human rights of freedom, compensation for labor, and control over their own body. He held hundreds of Africans enslaved in conditions that were horrible throughout his life and had sexual relations with a teenage girl. So we're calling for the removal of the statue. And while the statue is gone, we certainly will be able to have an opportunity to engage in business without encumbrances of reminders of people who did not have any regard for African Americans or for Native Americans. So with that, I thank you and I yield back my time.
Thank you, Council Member. Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. The stated meeting of June 25th, 2020 is hereby adjourned.